It's derby day at last. All winter, all spring, we wonder how we, and most of all the horses, will be when we reach this day. Well, we're here, they're here, and this time around, the puzzle as to how the individual pieces of racing form will fit is as tricky and intriguing as in any year I can remember. You're very welcome to Epsom Downs, to the same spot on which the first derby was run in 1780, to the course which today bids to hold its place as one of the most exciting natural sporting arenas of them all.
And when that derby was first run in 1780, it was worth just over £1,000 to the winner. Now, when the winning owner comes down here, the winning horse, and crosses the line here, the winning owner will pick up over £400,000. This is the richest derby there's ever been. Now, the favourite, probable favourite, is De Chantour, who's trained by Henry Cecil, ridden by Pat Eddery. They're hoping to pull off a classic double, because yesterday, their Lady Carla was a brilliant winner of the Oaks. But what about De Chantour? Well, he's looked after by stable lad Dave Goodwin, and he's already led up two former derby winners in Commander-in-Chief and Slip Anchor, and no stable lad has ever done three derby winners before. And what about Ladies First? These will be the silks to be worn by a lady jockey in the derby. Alex Greaves is the only lady jockey to use her changing room today. She'll be there on her own, but she'll make history. The first female ever to ride in the derby, even though her mount, Portuguese Lil, is the complete outsider. This is the 217th running of the most famous flat race in the world. And of all the major British sporting occasions, this has the longest history of them all.
216 years the Derby story stretches back, and it's worth remembering that when Diarmaid won the opening race in 1780, the course only stretched a mile and ran dead straight from beyond what is now the 5 furlong chute. The distance was increased to a mile and a half in 1784, and quite soon the race, as well as the course, often became crooked, culminating in the filthy 40s, when everybody was getting bribed or doped, and in 1844, when the winner Running Rain was disqualified because he was found to be a four-year-old. And that in a race when the favourite the Ugly Buck was pulled, the second favourite Rattan was doped, and another one Leander was brought down and killed at the top of Tattenham Corner. They didn't call this the dirtiest derby for nothing. The main protagonist against his roguery was Lord George Bentinck, who eventually quit racing and concentrated on politics, but not before he'd coined the phrase for the derby, the blue riband of the turf. Mind you, Lord George was a pretty fearless punter, having lost £26,000 on the 1826 St. Ledger. But his losses were nothing compared to the Marquis of Hastings, who in 1867, aged just 25, blew no less than £120,000 on the Derby. That represents at least £100 million in today's terms. Harry Hastings may have been rich and reckless, but not that rich. He was dead a year later. Another early Derby death was that of Fred Archer, but this was a hero slain by his own hand in a fit of depression brought on by the death of his wife and the ravages of wasting. He was only 29, but had already been champion jockey 13 times and won 5 derbies. The last with the best, Ormond, the Triple Crown winner, undefeated in 3 seasons on the track, truly one of the horses of the century. King Edward VII was an owner who straddled the 19th and 20th centuries, winning the derby as Prince of Wales with Persimmon and Diamond Jubilee, and in 1908 with Minoru becoming the only ruling monarch to see his colours triumph at Epsom. The derby and drama will always be intertwined, and in 1913, a suffragette, Emily Davison, lost her life when trying to stop the King George V's horse Anma at Tattenham Corner. Neither horse nor jockey were injured, but Emily paid the highest price for her cause. Whilst high prices came out in the race itself, the favourite Cragonard being disqualified, giving victory to Aboyeur at 100-1. 2 years later, Steve Donoghue was to have the first of his 6 derby successes. The first 2 at wartime Newmarket, and then 4 times in the 20s, showing a nerve and a style never bettered at Epsom. By 1931, television had come. It was very early days, but a move on from the flickering newsreels started in 1896, which from 1929 became sound as well.
In the straight, it's a 3-horse race. Windsor Lad is on the rails. Next to him is Lord Willavington's Eastern, second favourite to Columbo of the unbeaten record, who is coming up strongly on the outside. But Windsor Lad has just that bit in reserve. And wins.
When the war came again, the the Derby once more removed to Newmarket, with the spectators becoming massed ranks of servicemen in uniform. Fine horses like Owen Tudor and Watling Street were winners, but success continued to evade the most prolific jockey of them all, 26 times champion Gordon Richards. That is right up to coronation year of 1953. The young queen owned the much-fancied Oriole, but Gordon and the massive Pinzer saw to it that the Richards' luck would finally turn.
From now on, we can see just how Gordon brought his mount along with a devastating run that could only spell victory. When Pinzer passed Shaikampur, the Aga Khan's hopes faded right away, and Oriole, followed by Pink Horse, now came through to take second and third places. But the finish was all Pinzer, who went on to pass the post four lengths ahead of the Queen's Oriole and alone in the picture. Her Majesty was obviously most excited, even if victory had eluded her. She was clearly happy at the success of the jockey so signally honoured in the coronation list.
So to the present day, and the same historic horseshoe-shaped Epsom mile and a half has been dominated by a longer, much less talkative figure than Gordon Richards. Records are made to be broken, but few of us expect again to see the likes of nine times Derby-winning Leicester Piggott.
And it's Hotgrove who now takes it up. Hotgrove the leader, two furlong from home marker. The Minstrel second, Russian Groom is third. Then after leading three, make it run towards the outside, Monsenior. Million Dollar Man now dropping back. They run now towards the final furlong. It's Willie Cards on Hotgrove. Leicester Piggott on the Minstrel. That's the leading two. Russian Groom not going to make it. As they come now inside the final furlong, it's Leicester Piggott on the near side of the Minstrel. Hotgrove on the far side. It's between these two. It's going to be very close. The Minstrel on the near side, just the winner from Hotgrove. Russian Groom.
Queen's only missed one Epsom Derby since her coronation, and a little earlier, as usual, it was the arrival of the royal party which served as the curtain raiser for Derby Day. The band of the Brigade of Gurkhas was waiting in front of the stands as the royal party comes up the track. They've been driven up the track, in fact, since 1946. That was the first year King George VI was actually made a motorized arrival on Derby Day. The Queen in an attractive floral dress, I'm told that's the right description. It's very pretty anyway, and a lovely yellow hat, which as usual allows her face to be seen. It's an off the face. She is, of course, with the Duke of Edinburgh, and Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, is in the car behind. Now, soon after the Queen gets out, for the second year running, the Brigade of Gurkhas have come from Germany, and they will have the honour of playing God Save the Queen. Begins, and Her Majesty is greeted by the Board of United Racecourses. That's Tim Holland Martin, formerly a good amateur rider, Lord Halifax, whose father owned Shirley Heights and bred Shirley Heights. In the background, Christopher Sporborg, chairman of United Racecourses. Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother's dress, I'm reliably informed, is best described as turquoise. A very pretty turquoise dress, and how wonderful to see her walking pretty sound, at any rate, after her operation for the replacement of a hip. That's David Seif just being introduced to her. And later, I believe, the Queen is going to have a look. That David Seif being introduced, Christopher Spence, and later the Queen will see Lester Piggott's gates.
And now to the Derby field, the first look through the runners and riders, and confirmation this morning that Henry Cecil's second runner, Clever Cliché, has been withdrawn because of the lack of substantial overnight rain. That leaves just 20 runners for you and us to risk our money on. Michael Hills and William Haggis, the jockey and trainer of Shaamit. Shaamit, the horse who has only run once in his life, and that was last year, but he's been working brilliantly in Newmarket. It wouldn't be a huge surprise. And of course, as everybody knows, William Haggis, his father-in-law, is Lester Piggott, and it was Lester who said, yes, run him in the Derby.
Well, not surprisingly, it's our Premier Classics, so of course it attracts plenty of celebrities, many of which today are being entertained by the Prince's Trust. And three who join me now and who haven't stopped talking for the last 5 minutes are Clive Anderson, Frank Bruno and Britt Eklund.
I know.
Yeah. I've tried telling you.
I think we've missed the dog.
Shock news here. Shock news. I've just been talking to Frank Bruno. He's giving up boxing and he's becoming a jockey.
Yeah, that's
fantastic.
Yeah, that's
what a strange career move, Frank.
And I have decided to manage him as a jockey.
Do you think you can manage Frank?
Yes, I think so.
I know Frank has been to the Derby, has been to the Nationals. This is your first trip to Epsom.
First time, to the Derby. I'm looking forward to my trip. It's a good experience. OKR, jolly good.
Well, although you can't manage to be a jockey, do you follow the horses at all?
Not really. And I mean, I like horses. It's a sport, you know, so you've got to have respect for, you know, I mean, horses and or
athletes.
Jockeys. And yeah, it's athletes.
And they're big.
I'm not too sure. They're very, very big, the horses.
Britt Eklund's obviously a bit of an expert because she's been going around telling them all about the bedding in the stables, all about the horses.
Yeah, well, it is. They are allergic to hay, and that's why it's wood chips in there. And some people use plastic, and some people use newspaper.
Well, that apart, what are you thinking of backing this afternoon?
Okay, do you want to have all my tips?
Well, just do the Derby. We'll stick to that.
I'll give you my tip after your tip.
We'll go for Jack Jennings, Gloria Dancer, Even Top. Pronounce that. You must.
Dishcloth.
No.
DeChanteur.
And Double Leaf.
Right, well, that's enough. You got rid of half this.
My tip is I'm keeping my money in my pocket.
Well, in the first race, there's a horse called Lennox Lewis.
Is there? May do. I may trip that one up.
Now, Clive, I know you said you're not interested.
All of us, as the guests of the Prince's Trust, so there's a horse running called the Prince of Hearts. And I think that probably sums up the Prince of Wales. So I would recommend he's going to. Is that going to win?
Yes, he's
on
the Derby.
Not in the Derby. Obviously, can't win the Derby. He's not in it.
He might not win the Derby.
He's running today.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. That's all I know. Or the Jennings one. I've heard a lot of people say Jack Jennings.
Well done, Jack. Is it only? Well done. Well done, Obi.
Well, do make sure you go and look at the betting and give them the
betting. Well done, Obi. Well done. Jolly good.
Have a good day.
Yeah, I'm just going to go have a fight with the
princess. Well done, Obi.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you.
Don't scare the horses.
Bye.
Well, it's a well-oiled McCrerick machine on Derby Day, and you can see her, my wife, the booby. On your knees, booby. Get it all packed up, and I want the second sheet. Get it out quickly. The second sheet is the one I want. That's the booby looking after me, as she really ought to do. But there's no doubt about the Vodafone Derby that the class horse is Alareth. He topped the free handicap. Remember, the free handicap first compiled in 1928 shows who is considered to be the best juvenile. And five horses who've topped the free handicap have come on to win the Derby. Reference Point in 87, Grundy in 75, Nijinsky in 70, Dante in 1945, and 10 years earlier, Barham. So can Alareth become the sixth to do that? And you remember, last year, Celtic Swing, who topped the free handicap, didn't run in the Derby. And the last horse to top the free handicap and run in the Derby, the French colt Hector Protector, who was fourth to Generous in 91. And fourth in the 2000 Guineas was Alareth. But of course, Generous went on to win the Derby after being fourth in the Guineas. Blenheim in 1930 and Papyrus in 1923. Fourth in the Guineas had come on to win the Derby. But on the course, bookmakers pushed out Alareth. 13-2 they go and make Alareth. But imagine the emotive scenes there'd be if Willie Carson came back and gave Dick Hearn his fifth Derby, and Willie also his fifth on Alareth. But favourite DeChanteur, no doubt about it, on the shoulders, 9-2 against DeChanteur, that's favourite, with 11-2 Glory of Dancer. You can then get 13-2 against Alareth, and Even Top, and that's easy on the course. Bad vibes throughout the day and yesterday for Even Top. It's then 7-1 the Stormtrooper, 10-1 Shaamit, and 12 Double Leaf, 16 against Mystic Knight, and a bit of early money for number 4 Chief Contender, who did touch double carpet, 33-1 on the course, 40-1 chance in the offices, now put in 22-1. The Chief Contender, but DeChanteur is favourite, but Alareth, 13-2. Can you believe that could win for Carson? Meanwhile, booby, give me that sheet I told you to get. Go, so idle you are. Get on and do it. Aren't I lucky to have her?
Well, Breath, whatever happens here this afternoon, nobody will be able to offer the ground as an excuse. It's absolutely perfect conditions here this afternoon. Head groundsman Nigel Thornton has done a tremendous job. It's like Wembley, only it's better. There's not a weed to be seen anywhere. A good thick covering of grass, got a really good cushion to it. And as I said, they had a little bit of rain overnight. It's officially the far side of good, but really, no excuses for anything. A perfect racing surface.
And our first race is at 1:45, the Vodapage handicap. That's for 6 furlongs. Be blasting down there, no less than 17 of them. Then second on is the Derby. 20 go, as you know, Clever Cliché is being out. Clever Cliché is out of that, so 20 go in the Vodafone Derby, then £400,000 in prize money. Then at 3:10, the Patnick Apprentice handicap. There's one out of that. Western Playboy, number 12, is out. 13 go in that.
at 3.50, a 16 go in the Racing Channel handicap. And then we close with the finale, Group 1, the best older horses race run this season, the Vodafone Coronation Cup. Derby distance, a mile and a half, four runners, but it's class all the way. Four runners for the Vodafone Coronation Cup, that's at 4.25.
It's always difficult in any form of sport to take on the big boys and beat them, particularly in the world of racing where the big stables seem to get the best horse. But if hard work is anything to go by, then Glory of Dancer, who does boast very good form lines, has a great chance of winning because he's looked after by the Racing Callaway family. Paul is the trainer, of course, Gillian is the trainer's wife, and the horse is looked after by their son, Anthony. Now, what have the past 24 hours been like for them? We went along to their stables in Newmarket to find out. To Shalfleet Stables, where the first person you meet is a sometimes friendly Rottweiler called Dexter.
Got the flu? Got the whistle?
He's a tough hat now.
You've got to have a bit of guts to be a trainer, you know, and to have a cut, you've got to have a go, you know. I mean, if he breaks down, he breaks down, but you've got to give him the work. And luckily enough, he just liked the firm ground. So, I mean, that is a bonus with a dodgy-legged horse. At least he goes on the firm ground. Well, he's not really dodgy-legged, he just had an operation. And obviously, if you have cartilage removed, it must leave you with something missing. It's like a bit of a shop absorber removed. So, but he still copes with the firm ground well. Between us, we've managed to keep him sound and get him there on the day, you know, which is not an easy thing to do. My house, as you see, looks over the yard. I'm within 10 yards of his box. He sleeps nearer to me than my wife probably tonight.
All I do is I just sort of nurse them if they're ill, and sit up with them if they're very ill, and feed them and look after their well-being and ride out. Whatever, you know, whatever's needed, they need me to ride out. I'm good on stupid horses that won't walk and other people get upset with them. I never get upset with them, so I'm very casual on them. That's why I fall off quite regularly, I think.
But casual is one of the things that runs through the yard to a certain extent. It's clearly professional. It's a business operation that's being run here. But nevertheless, it seems that people are enjoying their working environment and they can do it in a relaxed way. We've been to plenty of yards in the last couple of weeks that are run like military operations. This isn't one of them, is it?
Well, you see, we haven't got many horses which help, so you can be very choosy who you employ. And all our lot love the horses. And that's, I won't stand for anyone that knocks them about or any of that nonsense. I mean, they're mostly other people's property. And horses are horses. You know, they're not made of wood. You want them to be full of beans and lively. You know, they're horses, they should be tearing about and happy. So to hit a horse when he's happy is disgusting, you just break their spirit. So I just believe in them being happy. Well, they're like, just like the dogs and the cats around, you know, everybody's sort of, it's a family really. And odd things jet in through the winter to get fed, the word gets around. I've got two guinea fowl, I don't know whose they are, they just appeared and they stay, Bill and Ben, and you know, you get all these odd things. We've got quite a few friendly rats. I have an arrangement with them. If they leave my oak bins alone, I give them some mash at night. Probably encourages them, but still. Everything's got a right to live in my book, so I'm an animal person.
My mother does the feeding. She's up. She probably works the hardest in the yard. She really puts her back into it. And father's the linchpin. I happen to look after and ride the horse, so I give as much advice as my feelings on the horse, having ridden good horses in the past. The information that came over with the horse was that he liked soft ground, and I was convinced that he wanted firm ground. And it's just putting the whole puzzle together and all pulling together to get the best results. You know, all pitching our brains in together. Sometimes the discussions get quite heated. We all quite often have a different opinion. But we're all pulling towards the same direction to get the best out of the horse that we have. Get the best out of the material, which is Glory of Dancer at the moment. So because we're a small yard, we don't have that many runners. My father gets to see most of the runners. So basically, I just fit in where possible. I speak several languages, so I take all the horses abroad. They're always important runners. And the Italian owners I get to speak to in person. So when I found out this fellow was coming, as the year before, with Pelda, both he and Pelda had both won Group 1 races. So their class horses coming in the yard. So I said, yeah, I'll look after him. So I bagged them first. So there you go.
I'm quite relaxed until they're down at the start, and then my heart bangs so loudly I think everyone's going to hear it. And often I have to go into the ladies, shut myself in there for a bit, until they're running, and I usually watch it on telly so I can see every move they make and see how they go in the stalls and how they come out, and then rush for the last bit maybe, but I'll try and get to watch it on telly. I mean, you won't see anything there anyway.
Looking down on the racecourse tables where Glory of Dancer will be ready now, because the time ticks towards the Derby, and with us is his jockey. A first trip to Epsom for Olivier Pellier. Welcome to Epsom Downs.
Thank you.
What do you think about Epsom as a racecourse, unlike anyone you've seen, I imagine?
Yes, it's a very special racecourse, but I have a very good teacher, just Non-Franco, very good teacher me, and I like it. You have many, many people, a good ambience. I like it.
What have you done to prepare, Olivier? Have you walked around the course?
Yes, I walked yesterday, and I see all the race, and it's just a little bit special. And I walk maybe two times here for the turn, but I think it's okay.
And tell us about your experience of riding this horse. It was first of all in Italy last year.
As my first experience, but now I ride the first race. The six furlong is different, but I ask Maurice Dilbert and Mr. Fab, I see Mr. Calloway and all the people, and many I see many tapes, all the winner for the Derby, but all the winner is my head.
Yeah, and these old Derbies, how do you think your horse will adapt to what you've seen? How do you think he will handle Epsom?
But if you have a good start and maybe a good position, not so good go outside, because the first Tattenham Corner is a very little bit special, and if my horse is ready, is very strong, maybe if you win, I'm very happy.
Well, you've won all over the world. I know you've won title in Japan, and so is Frankie Dettori. You've won all over the world. Tell us about Olivier. You've got to be that nice. How's he going to handle Epsom? It must be a disadvantage being here first time.
Well, he's a world-class jockey, and I don't think he'll find Epsom any trouble at all.
No trouble at all? Not.
No, I don't think so. I mean, he's got the right horse. He's ridden many a times. He's a world-class jockey. He's ridden everywhere in the world, and I don't think Epsom will be any trouble to him.
But Epsom is, though, a problem to ride, isn't it? It is a special challenge for you jockeys. Tell us about the most difficult thing you think about Epsom.
It is a special track to ride. Basically, if you're on the right horse, it's quite easy. I mean, I didn't have any trouble on pre-cat yesterday. But obviously, if you haven't got the gas to, you know, to keep your position, or, you know, if you ride a horse what doesn't handle the downhill, then of course you are in trouble. But it's not down to the jockey's being, it's down to the horse. And I think Olivier today is on a special horse, and it'll give him a good ride round.
Well, let's first of all talk about your horse here, an outsider, Shantou, but he did win last time. As you know, many people back you blind, Frankie. Are they being silly to back you blind?
Well, this morning I went and I got a new haircut, just in case, just to change my luck a little bit. But, I mean, Shantou is got an outsider's chance, and we're taking a chance like the rest. And I'm not saying he's going to win, but I'd just like to see him run a nice race, and if we're thereabouts, we'll go for it.
Well, some horses circling out here, Frankie. Now, just walking around, getting readied. Well, it's a bit difficult. We're wondering whether we can say which one's which, but we're a long way from them, Frankie, here.
Yes,
you'll recognise your horse from that distance. You're even better than I thought you were.
I mean, we've been talking about it's been his open derby, and an open derby it is, and you can't rule out about 10 horses in the race. And let the best horse win. Let it be a clean race, anyhow.
Glory of Dancer. Are you sure he will stay the trip, the distance, from what you feel so far?
I think the distance is not a problem, because the father, he win Irish Derby at 2,400 meters, but today is the same distance, but I don't think the distance is a problem.
And you seem very calm, but before a big race, do you get tight with your nerves, or do you find you just enjoy it?
No, I just enjoy it, but I have many people, is Derby Epsom, just a little bit freezing. I'm very happy, very happy.
Well, both of you, it's good to have you on, and
thank
we'll
you.
See one of you happy afterwards, perhaps.
Well, let's hope so.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I just found Alex Greaves here, just having a gentle stroll up to the track. This is the girl who's making history today. No girl has ever worn silks in the Derby in 217 years. So what's the feeling like?
It's nice to be able to be here. It's everybody's dream to get a ride in the race, and hopefully we'll get around and enjoy it and have a good ride.
I mean, what chance have you got? Come on, he's 500 to 1. People are backing him to be last.
Yeah, I mean, obviously she's an outsider chance on the form, but it's a very open race and there's no reason why she shouldn't pass one or two up the straight.
You seem very calm about this because the past few weeks you must have been interviewed by just about everybody. What's it been like?
Hectic. Absolutely hectic. The last 2 weeks I don't think we've had time to sit down, so probably be bored to tears next week.
It's all a bit different. So is it overfacing you in any way or not?
Not at the moment. I mean, obviously the moment you get on them and you get out, it's going to be different. But at the moment it's not too bad. I'm just going to enjoy it and I might never get the chance again.
Now, how much could you enjoy it? Because out there in any derby or in any race, no quarter is given. So what's it like for a woman against these guys out there?
I mean, obviously, I've never ridden in a derby before. Same as one or two of the other jockeys, so it's going to be new to a few of us, but I ride with them every day, we're professional, we'll all go out there to do a professional's job.
And you've already got plenty of firsts to your name, just tell us about the first.
Obviously the first girl to lose my claim, first to ride 100 winners, and obviously the Lincoln as well, first to win a big handicap like the Lincoln.
And you've got a lucky draw today, tell us about that.
Lucky 10, they say it's the lucky draw where the winners come from, so yeah. Well, fingers crossed.
Five winners out of the past 10 years have come out of stall 10.
Ten.
Yeah. But what's it like in the lady jockeys room? You're there all on your own?
Well, no, Amy Cook's got riding the apprentice, so
good.
I've got a little bit of company today.
Right.
Not too bad.
Well, I wish you all the very best and safe journey.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thanks.
So from Alex Greaves and Derek Thompson getting a feel of conditions, the horses that in about an hour will be participating in this year's Derby. Just having a feel too. There's Even Top, distinctive in size, he's a great big round barreled horse, and of course the fact he wears a sheepskin noseband means that he stands out perhaps more than one or two of the other bays. Ears pricked, you can't say any more than he doesn't appear to be, from these pictures, to be sweating, which is a good thing at this stage because the race is still an hour away, and he seems to have an equable temperament. Not just stable lads here, Sheikh Mohammed and his team relaxing before the big event. Sheikh Mohammed has an outsider this year, but of course he's ploughed millions into bloodstock and has a classic under his belt with the Godolphin operation through Mark of Esteem in the Guineas. Second yesterday with Prickett. Oh, that's a nice scene. Good luck, well wishes, Alex Greaves. Alex may be the first lady to ride in the Derby, but the Chelsea pensioners have been very much part of this for years, very much part of the tradition.
And a whole lot of families coming to this Saturday Derby. You'll know that last year's switch from traditional Wednesday didn't seem an outstanding success, and there's quite a body of opinion now wanting to switch back to the traditional Wednesday. Decisions will be taken after studying today's attendance. Personally, I think it'd be more logical to give it another year and assess it over a three-year period and try next year without the competition of Euro 96. Certainly, looking at today, no one could say that this was a poorly attended occasion. It's a huge occasion nonetheless, and I don't think racing should cower before other sports, but clearly there is an opinion about Wednesdays, and let's look at that. But let's not run away from the original decision to switch to Saturdays, because Wednesday wasn't going very well. Saturday is the big leisure day, it's when the Kentucky Derby's run, it's when the Grand Nationals run, but all the big sports events are held, and I believe the Derby on a Saturday could still become the greatest flat race, Saturday flat race, as well as the greatest flat race of the year. People come for derbies in all sorts of reasons. This appears to be a Euro 96 t-shirt, slightly expanded, but they were here. They can watch Euro 96 too, but above all they're here to watch the Derby of 96. 22 of these open top buses there are, and will they see yet another Derby for that great trainer, Dick Hearn, who's with Derek Thompson?
I think if Dick Hearn can win, he'll get the biggest cheer today, you and Willie. It must be quite something coming back here on Derby Day. Many special memories for you, Dick?
Oh, certainly. I mean, there's nothing like the Derby. Mm. And every jockey, every trainer and owner wants to win. Mm. So it's great to be back here with a runner.
Now, I've got to ask you, before we start talking, how is it for you here at the Derby? Because, I mean, there's hundreds of thousands of people. How difficult is it for you? Have you got a good vantage point or what?
Well, I have to watch on television. Mm. And there's one outside the weighing room I can watch.
Yeah.
See, if I go up in the stand, by the time I get down, they've weighed out to go out for the next race.
Yeah, so it's difficult.
I've got to be somewhere handy.
Do you remember that old saying in racing, fourth in the Guineas, first in the Derby?
I certainly do.
Is it going to apply to Al Haas?
Well, I haven't got my crystal ball with me, but I certainly hope so. Mm. The horse is well, and he'll handle the ground, I think. Mm-hmm. Be quite fast today.
Yeah, it will be fast. It's an open race, and
very open.
It's a good race.
A marvellous race. And a fair few have dropped out, which always helps. Mm. And especially as they were fancied ones.
Well, on behalf of everybody watching, I think they'll say with me, good luck, Major Dick Hearn today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And although Dick Hearn's last winner on the flat, as the Racing Post revealed today, was Al Hareth himself when he won the Dewhurst last October, and his 30 subsequent entries have all been beaten, the public don't care about that. Usually popular with them and with Willie Carson. The smaller punter's money, no doubt, will be with the class horse, Al Hareth. There's other betting today as well, so let's look ahead to the tissues. These are the bookmakers' forecasts of how the betting will go. And in the 3.10, they go 5-1, Dance So Sweet, with 11-2, Arctic Courier, Royce in Clover and Country Lover, 7, Benfleet and Casual Water, and 8, Hatter Fay, very light betting heat that. In the 3.50, the money, as I told you on the morning line this morning, was for Hugwitty, number 10, is now into 3-1 from 7-2, with 5-1 Tersham, 6 Hardy Dancer and Hazard, I guess, and 10-1 Ho Express. And in the Coronation Cup, a hugely disappointing opening 4 runners. They're going 11-10 Swain, 11-8 Sing Spiel, 9-2 De Quest, and 16-1 against Punishment. And those of you who watch the morning line, Channel 4, 9-10 every Saturday morning. The other horses, I said, were being backed early in the 1:45, a number 4, Lennox Lewis, and number 11, Bowden Rose, and that's proving so on the course. Lennox Lewis was an 8-1 chance, is now 11-2 favourite, and Bowden Rose was 15-2, is now 13-2 against Bowden Rose. So they're the two horses backed here, Lennox Lewis and Bowden Rose. Watch the Channel 4 morning line. Saturday morning, 9 o'clock, you get all the early market moves. You can go and beat the bookies, at least by getting the price then.
On the morning line, I said, I've never been on one of these open top buses before. I'm going to. Aye. Are you all right?
Yes.
You had a good day out?
Yes.
Now, what's going to win the Derby
Glory
today?
Glory Dancer.
Glory of Dancer.
Yeah. What about Al
Haas? Yeah. Al Haas. Oh, Willie Carson.
Double Leaf.
You fancy that? The Dark double Horse. What's going to win?
Oh, yes, number 2.
Number 2. What's number 2? Al Haas. Right. They're next door. Come in here. Let's see what's going on these buses. Now, look at this. This is where the work is done. You all right, girls? How many more of these have you got to do?
About
100.
Soak up the alcohol.
Let's see who's going to be consuming the alcohol. Coming up. Plenty of room upstairs. Oh, my goodness. Look at this lot. Come and join us down here. Now, how long have you guys been coming to the Derby? How long?
Since I was in Nassau.
6 years.
45 years. Where's the oldest man? How long have you been organising all this?
1978.
Brilliant. And where are you all from? Are you all in the same club or company?
Insurance.
You're on insurance? And this is your one day out every year?
It's all we're allowed.
Yeah. Oh, something like that. The one sober day.
The one sober.
I'm all right. There's a lot of legs in.
Oh, look at this. Look at that. you not feel embarrassed?
Yeah. You should have seen it before you put the shorts on.
No, thank you. It's a family show. Now, fellas, what's going to win the derby?
Mystic Knight.
Mystic Knight. You fancy that? Any
Storm
other?
Trooper.
Stormtrooper.
Stormtrooper.
Stormtrooper. Let's, Craig, anybody else?
I hope it's Classic Eagles. They've got shares in that.
Oh, so. Great. That's good, that. So, anyway, you're going to have a good... Where are the girls, by the way? Where are the wives? They're downstairs. I've got to ask you, I say on the morning line today, I've always wanted to watch the derby from the top of an open day club. What's it actually like? What's it like having
a
day?
If it doesn't rain, it's fantastic.
If it doesn't rain, it's fantastic. Is it a lovely day out?
Great day.
Have a good one, fellas, and back to the winner. See you later. Bye-bye.
That was recorded earlier by the look of some of those undergarments we were seeing. Perhaps it was just as well. I dread to see what state they'll be in by the end of the day. The rooftop buses, no finer place to try and survive the Epsom ordeal. Can you triumph at Epsom? Can you win the Champs and Tipster? The details from Simon.
And we have five live races this afternoon for you. The Derby at 2:25. Now, we're looking for three selections per race in the Champion Tipster competition. Points are scored according to the SP by all finishers in the first three. And there's plenty of money to be won here. The highest aggregate total wins £5 per point. Now, you register your selections on 0891 991148. 0891 991148. Now, here's the scoring system. Starting prices of less than 2-1 score 1 point, and basically you score more points, the bigger the odds, and points lead to prizes. 0891 991148.
Five races to come live here on Channel 4, the first of them after this break.
We can't allow this to happen.
You what?
What you propose threatens our very existence. Suppose you were to go back and inadvertently kill your own grandfather, changing the course of history. This facility must be terminated.
It's not doing any harm.
You wrote to your brother. I have crafted our kid. I can now isolate a single second in time. I'm in control. I needn't worry about me finances again.
With the Vodafone digital network, I'm charged by the second, not the minute. So I'm finally in control of me finances.
The Vodafone network. You were talking about your phone bill.
Yeah, and excuse me, but how could a karaoke machine kill me granddad? So merry,
we'll just have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
Celebrate Euro 96 with the Sunday Telegraph tomorrow and get Monday's best-selling quality daily for only 10 pence. Take part. Take the Telegraph for 10 pence.
Selhurst Park Flyer has the spread of plates, so easy to do with these very light racing plates. Spread of plate and is being reshod at this minute. But let's take in a race here, the Vodapage handicap, which has 6 furlongs, and it's interesting enough, the favourite we've just seen, Frank Bruno, is the horse called Lennox Lewis. There are 17 of them listed by Graham Good.
And 15, 16 of them down at the start, one to go.
number one is drawn to. That's Shamanic 25-1. The top weight, Dane O'Neill claiming three from stall one. Go Heaver Golf 10-1 with Cash Asmussen. From 12, Shikari's Son 40-1. Richard Quinn from 7, Lennox Lewis 6-1. Pat Edery. From 10, Silent Expression 25-1. Michael Kinnan rides. From 15, the Visored Lago di Verano 20-1 chance with Dale Gibson. From 14, twice as sharp 12-1 and Gary Hine. From 3, My Best Valentine 16-1. Tony Whelan claiming 3, and from stall 4, a 25-1 chance, Tropical Dance, John Reed on board. That from stall 11 is the blinkered Happy Fox, Johnny Murta rides, a 12-1 chance, and from 8, the blinkered Bowden Rose, 11-2 favourite, Jimmy Quinn. From 6, Sweet Magic, 14-1, Paul Edery. From 9, Silhurst Park Flyer, just making his way down to the start, that chap, 12-1, Paul Roberts claiming 5. From 16, Golden Pound, 12-1, Olivier Pellier. From 17, Thatcherella, 15-2, and Brent Thompson. From stall 5, the 20-1 chance, Joe Maximus, Alan Daly claiming 5. And from 13, the Visored Sea Thunder, a 20-1 chance, with Frankie Dettori on board. This is the VodaPage handicap. It's over 6 furlongs. And with the exception of Selhurst Park Flyer, they're all down at the start.
The airship, which has our overhead camera. In the old days, hardly anybody ever knew what happened in the Derby. Now everybody can see virtually everything. All we lack is a camera on the horse's nose. And give us time, give us time. We have a best turnout horse here. First, number 8, My Best Valentine. David Bowen has won £100 from the sponsors Vodafone for that. And here are the other winners so far, the eye catchers for what our team at this last minute think looks best in their own areas. In the paddock, the Happy Fox stands out, going down. Graham Good liked the way Tropical Dance moved. It's not a tip in itself, but it's what they were most impressed by. In the ring for John Lennox, Lewis and Bowden Rose are going best, trading best, and Thatcherella is trading worst. And looking through this particularly tricky handicap, try and make sense of what will be a real helter-skelter. Jim McGrath and first John Franken.
Yeah, it's a wonderful race to begin the afternoon with, bruv. 17 runners dashing down this straight 6 furlongs. And normally you'd say that the high numbers have a slight advantage. And, well, just coming slightly round the bend. 5 furlongs, of course. Fairly fast course, Jim.
And there's one of the horses that's been back for this, Bowden Rose, who looks extremely well, very much G'd up and jazzed up by proceedings. Ran her best race of the season last time out at Newmarket. We showed that to you. A well-handicapped and well-backed horse, Top Banana, came and beat her, so it was no disgrace to go down to that one, and on the pick of her form from last year, she got every chance of winning this afternoon.
Did you think she looked as well as she did last week at Newmarket?
Well, I must be honest, I mean, I know you and I disagree about this. I didn't see her last week because I was in a different area for Channel 4, but I think she looks perfectly well, and I mean, she's not got worn between her legs, which any number of the horses have. She's perked up and ready to go. I think she's fine.
Yeah, I just thought she was slightly more settled last week. Real helter-skelter here. Got to be fast and be able to hold a good position.
Yeah, the draw's often very important here, because if you get a horse that is a front runner, it's drawn wide, it has to use up an awful lot of energy. Bowden Rose drawn more or less centre, 8 of 17. So her rider has got every option of making a plan to suit himself. It'll be wide open, this, in terms of betting. Bowden Rose, probably one of the favourites. Here's a full show.
And indeed, Bowden Rose is the market leader at 11-2, well back two from 13-2. At 6-1, Lennox Lewis, showing at 8-1, then Thatcherella. Go Heaver Golf at 10-1. On 12s, the Happy Fox, twice as sharp. Selhurst Park Flyer and Golden Pound. Sweet Magic is a 14-1 chance, along with Sea Thunder. On 16s, Joe Maximus and My Best Valentine, and it's 20-1 bar.
Thank you.
Just beginning to spit with rain here. Let's hope it doesn't get any worse than that. It would be ironic if all the fine weather disappears just when we wanted to stay. I didn't know that the Queen followed sprint handicaps to any great degree. but racing in general fascinates her. And although none of these particular runners will ever reach the blue blood stakes as regards stud values, I suppose she just might have in one or two of her broodmares at home a relative distance to one or two of these competing here.
15 favourites have won this in 37 running since the war, and the favourites have flip-flopped. Lennox Lewis out to 6-1 as better support has come from Bowden Rose. 13-2 into 11-2, but one or two bookmakers are calling 6-1 the field. That's each of two. Out to 8-1 is Thatcherella, and about the best of the outside is My Best Valentine. Fifth last year at 16-1. Gigi, call this lot home. Good luck, Gigi.
That's it, lining up then for this 6 furlong dash. It gets us off to a start here. Just getting a little bit fractious go here at golf on Vodafone Derby Day. That's it, lined up, and they kick away in a pretty level break. Bowden Rose not that keen to go, and so Silent Expression a little bit slow to its stride, the grey in the midfield. Silhurst Park Flyer is showing plenty of dash. Go Heaver Golf on the extreme right in the black jacket, and it's Go Heaver Golf that leads in Silhurst Park Flyer, and into a prominent position now Silent Expression. Sweet Magic the inside, and also running fast on the inside is Shamanic, followed through by Joe Maximus. Wide on the course is Golden Pound, and they start the turn for home, and it's a Go Heaver Golf that just has the edge. With the noseband on the outside is the one that was slow to start, that was a Selhurst Park Flyer. Through into third place, My Best Valentine, then comes Shamanic, Joe Maximus, Silent Expression. Yellow colours on the outside, twice as sharp, past the 2 furlong marker, and Selhurst Park Flyer goes on. Here comes My Best Valentine in the yellow and blue behind it. Shamanic starts to pick up, and then comes Joe Maximus, Golden Pound behind the ears, but it's a duel with a furlong to go between next to the rails. Selhurst Park Flyer with the noseband is proving the stronger of My Best Valentine, and Selhurst Park Flyer going on. Selhurst Park Flyer lengthening his stride, My Best Valentine in second. At the post, Selhurst Park Flyer, My Best Valentine, Tropical Dance finishes third. Then comes Shamanic and Joe Maximus, and twice as sharp and Golden Pound, the Happy Fox, and then Sea Thunder, followed by Bowden Rose and Chicago Sun and Largo Di Verrana and Thatcherella and Silent Expression. Then Lennox Lewis, and last to pass the post was Sweet Magic. 12-1 then, the winner of this, the Vodapage handicap. That's number 13 on the card in the colours of Chris Deuter's, trained by Jack Berry, and although this horse had to be reshod before going down to the start, came back with tremendous effect. Paul Roberts rides. Second horse home, that's number 8, My Best Valentine, the yellow cap there, worn by Tony Whelan's. Apprentices 1 and 2 on this opening day on in the Vodapage handicap. The third horse home is number 9, Tropical Dance. John Reed rides, the blue and white colours there at the back. And the fourth horse home, the top weight Shamanic, Dane O'Neill. But our winner, with his ears pricked, is trained by Jack Berry, and that's Selhurst Park Flyer. Paul Roberts rides.
Well, Paul Roberts may claim £5, but he can be well pleased with himself here. He's shown commendable coolness. It's a tight, was a tight finish, or looked like being a tight struggle for a long way. But if you talk about Epsom being about balance, i.e. keeping your horse balanced on a course that lends itself to making the animal do the opposite because of the nature of its undulations, then this is a good example of a job done really well. Admittedly, he's on a horse that's, to use a slang phrase, travelling, i.e. always going well. But John, I was really impressed with him.
Yeah, I've been impressed with him before, Jim, and more than anything, I just thought that he kept really cool when he was challenged. He was actually headed about the furlong pole by Tony Whelan on My Best Valentine. And just have a look when he comes along there. You can see he rides with a really sensible length of iron. He's able to help horses. That's important round here. You don't want to be perched up too high. You want to be able to keep them balanced. And, well, I think Jack Berry would be more than pleased with the way that he's ridden this horse. Quite surprised in the end. It looked a very competitive handicap, how two came away from the field.
Yeah, underlines again the nature of this track. Very fast, and those that got away on quickish ground, they don't come back unless they go ridiculously fast-paced, and this horse gets 6 furlongs really well. There was never any chance of that happening.
Confirmation of the SP and a huge result to start Derby Day. A bookmaker's benefit. First number 13, Selhurst Park Flyer at 12-1. Second number 8, My Best Valentine at 16-1. Third, number 9, Tropical Dance at 25-1. And they pay on the fourth in a big field. Number 1, Shamanic was fourth at 25-1. Number 11, Bowden Rose, 11-2 favourite, 17 ran.
One of the wooliest parts of science is trying to assess the crowd on Derby Day. The figure much bandied around at 56,000 last year was the figure in the enclosures of the grandstand. The actual figure is any number of 100,000 plus if you take the whole crowd, the whole downs and all the rest of it. And what one has to think, looking around here, and from my position looking out around, is how many more people do you want to come here? Because there's only a certain amount of space, and if you have it at a reasonable comfort, then you can really enjoy it. No doubt that Her Majesty has a reasonable amount of space, but other parts of the downs, it can get extremely crowded, and I personally have no wish to hanker back to 1867 when the whole place was just a teeming, appalling, filthy multitude. I think that it wants to be pleasant for everybody who comes, and then hopefully for all of you who kindly watch too. They're all here. We're all ready. The Derby is on next, win or lose, after the break.
In the last year, we've delivered over 15,000 days. But we didn't sell one of them. Because Dayu only has customer advisors who won't approach you unless you ask them to. So, if you want, you can go in and out of a Dayu showroom without anyone ever crossing your path except to say hello. A car company that only has non-commissioned advisors? That'll be the Dayu.
We understand you're in touch with people from the other side.
Di! Di! Put these away for me, Di.
Is it true you're in touch with the other side?
Oh, yes. Old Mrs. Jones, Seven's the post. They may be in a faraway place now, but that's no problem for me.
Can you demonstrate your ability to contact the others?
If you like.
You use a mobile phone?
Oh, yes. With the Vodafone digital network, you see, I can easily reach people on the other side. Or Festiniog, Betrisacoid, Sanfair, Pwllgwyngyr, Gogera, Gwynrobert, Llantysilio, Gogogoch, all over the place. Gwynnes, I have a couple of funny city folk here. Could you have a word?
I guess we'll have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
I phoned for a copy of the Apple Tango pin-up calendar. And it hasn't done me any harm.
£11,215 plus...
That's just for the car, Tom. Now add £605 for delivery and road tax, then add servicing, that's £472. Dayu price forms help you compare the cost of buying and owning a Dayu with buying and owning a competitor's car. Dayu think that they should make it this easy. After all, an 8-year-old can do it. Don't forget air conditioning. So, Tom, what does that make?
That's over £2,000 more.
For more information, phone 0800 666 222. Everything included on a Dayu. That'll be the Dayu price.
Epsom, as we close towards Derby time, it's 25 past is the off time this year for reasons we all know about, to avoid the Euro 96 clash. But you're going to see plenty of soccer later. Here is where it's really beginning to count now. And in the weighing room, jockeys too know that they are within minutes of their chance for a place in history. There's Richard Quinn with John Dunlop, who rides St Maul's. Outside it, and there's Michael Kinnan with Henry Cecil. Different instructions from York, no doubt. He's going to go up there with the leaders for certain this time. Might go all the way. Frankie Dettori, who rides Shantou. An outsider, but he won last time. In fact, he can go out without a worry in his mind here. No great heavy responsibility of a heavily backed horse. Coming through there is Prince of My Heart, Brent Thompson. Outsider two from Barry Hills, two horses, Busy Flight being the other. Brent, who's ridden twice in the Derby, but not been placed as yet. The leader, of course, Woody Carson, who's won four. Pat Hedry has won three for the moment. And no less than 12 of these jockeys have actually never ridden in the Derby before. Frankie, so far, has been second once, which was, of course, last year with Temuore. Dana Neal sitting there. He has the tote returns now on the last race.
The 1-2-3-4 Selhurst Park Flyer 12-1, My Best Valentine 16-1, Tropical Dance at 25-1, Shamanic also 25-1. The Wind Tote paid £12.20 and places paid £2.20, £3.40, £5.30 and £8.30. The dual forecast £154.70. Bowden Rose the 11-2 favourite there and 17 ran.
Her Majesty coming out of the stands to go and look at the horses in the paddock, being a connoisseur, and I think that's the right word, of the racing game. It's a part of the operation she enjoys most, looking at these thoroughbreds in the paddock. And don't forget, in her coronation year, she looked at her own horse, Oriole, and she's at the Piggott gates, and there is Lester Piggott himself, with Roy Miller, who is the artist who has designed the plaque on the side of these gates, with Edward Gillespie there, the chief executive of United Racecourses, and of course the man who's mastermind of Cheltenham too. This lovely idea to have a montage of Lester Piggott's winners of the Coronation Cup, the Oaks and the Derby, his 9 winners of the Derby, on these gates. Football has its Shankly gates, the cricket has the Grace gates, and racing now has the Lester Piggott gates at Epsom. You see there the two montages, and the two images of Piggott are the boy Piggott, who was just 16 when he first rode in the Derby on Gay Time, and indeed won the when he won the Coronation Cup on Zucchero in 1953, and was into his 50s when Tinoso was the last of his 9 Derby victories. I notice to be a more relaxed figure now, but in fact, in many ways, he was relaxed for a long time towards the end, because he'd cracked it. He'd done the most difficult thing of all. He'd made the supremely tricky and dangerous art of race riding around Epsom seem almost easy. Lester Piggott didn't have problems coming down the hill. He says now that they are difficult, but he was always in a good position at the top of the hill, and they rolled down the hill. He said to me once, they always come down the hill first time. It's when they come back for the Coronation Cup they have trouble. But an inspired idea, the Lester Piggott gates here at Epsom, the race course, in his own way, he made his own, and it now has its royal recognition.
And Lester Piggott, the man bookies down the ages, feared in the Derby. Now, early reports in the betting shops not too encouraging. No bookmakers reporting great huge increases in turnover on the Derby. Far more open this year than when Penny Camp was 11-8 favourite a year ago. Early reports, and of course this will be substantiated later on one way or the other, not too encouraging. But what is working by coming racing, betting 1, 2, 3, 4 places. And plenty of bookmakers are doing that. And grow up, stupid idiot. Plenty of bookmakers are going the fourth place, like John White, Bob Pittard, Barry Dennis, Joe Bates, M&J from Slough, G&T Williams, JC and several others, giving four places, selling the profession. The great racing day, encouraging people to come racing tax-free. If your horse is fourth and you're not here on the course having batted each way, you will be gutted, and it serves you right for not coming racing. The early betting now, they are going 9-2 Duchiantor, 6-1 Glory of Dancer, 13-2 Even Top and 7 Stormtrooper. Opposition to Al Haref, I have seen 8-1 in a place, but generally 15-2 Al Haref, 11-1 Shaamit and 12-1 Double Leaf. Easy prices, bookmakers pushing them out, wanting to get money, but the four places, you can get them here on the course.
Just walking into the parade ring here with Lester Piggott. That must have been a nice moment, that showing Her Majesty the Lester Piggott gates.
Ah, oh, terrific, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, the They've come up so well on those days.
They have. Do you remember we were down at your place a few weeks ago?
Yeah.
They look really good. Yeah.
Really good. Yeah.
I've got to ask you, you know, you've been here so many years, but even now, not riding, what's it like for you? Do you still feel...
Right, you still feel... You know, it's going to be a great race, I think.
Yeah.
Still a very open race, you know. But, you know, I think I also got a good chance, really.
Shaamit.
Yeah. Yeah. I hope so, anyway. You know.
If you could pull the breeches on and the boots, which one would you like to get on?
Him.
Shaamit. You think he can win it first time out this season?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
It's asking a lot, you know, but... it's happened before, you know.
Yeah.
And I hope he'll be there, you know.
Should be a good race.
So we're hoping to the best, you know.
Would you like to be out there?
Of course I would, you know.
Ah, I tell you what, we all wish you were. Anyway, enjoy it, and good luck for your son-in-law.
Yeah, thank you,
Lester.
He makes you want to reach for your wallet, doesn't he? Starts saying that. Well, we'll know soon enough. There are 20 runners here. Remember, clever cliche is a non-run that withdrawn because there was no heavy overnight rain. 20 runners, £523,000 for the winner. The Vodafone Derby Stakes. Here are the runners and riders from Graham.
And number one is Ashane, drawn 11. A 200-1 chance with Warren O'Connor riding his first Derby ride. Al Hareth, 15-2, Willie Carson. Busy Flight, 33-1, Catch Asmussen. Chief Contender, 22-1, another one of the many jockeys, nine, having their first Derby ride, David Harrison in the yellow jacket. Classic Eagle is 150-1, good name, Alan Mackay rides. Clever Cliche doesn't take part, Double Leaf does so at 12-1 with Johnny Murtagh, he's having his first ride. Dushyanto, the 9-2 favourites, partnered by Pat Edery, who's worn those colours before. Even top at 13-2 chance with Philip Robinson riding. Horse that was second in the Potemps 2000 Guineas. Glory of Dance was 6-1. Olivier Pellier in yellow and blue, he will be. Jack Jennings, 20-1. John Reed. Mystic Knight, 16-1. Kevin Daly. Prince of My Heart, 66-1. Brent Thompson in blue and white. Shaamit, 11-1 chance, tipped by Lester Piggott, no less. Michael Hills rides. Shantou, 33-1 now with Frankie Dettori. Spartan Heartbeat, 200-1 chance. Mark Birch paying his first visit to the Derby. And walked the course earlier this morning. St. Moore's 20-1, Richard Quinn rides. Stormtrooper down to 7-1, Michael Kinnan on board. Tasted a 200-1 chance, Willie Supple, a pacemaker this one. Zaforum 100-1, Dane O'Neill, an apprentice, champion apprentice possibly this year. He's having his first Derby ride, and so is Alex Greaves. Good luck to her, and well done the connections of Portuguese Lille. A 500-1 chance, but they've paid their money to be here, and boy are they going to enjoy it. It's the Vodafone Derby, it's the 217th Derby, and the horse is now in the parade ring.
And a far more pleasant afternoon for horses than yesterday, when it might have looked wonderful, but it was decidedly humid and sweaty. Number nine, Even Top, has taken the preliminaries so far in admirable fashion. He isn't a great exaggerated walker like one or two of the others are. He doesn't go with any great swing, but he's happy, well in himself, and second in the Guineas, has every chance here.
Chief Contender is a course record holder at Salisbury. He hasn't really taken on anything too special as yet, but he's won both of his last races, and he certainly looks the part. Peter Chappell-Hyam has had the runner-up in both the French and Italian Derby so far this year. And this horse, well, he could easily spring a surprise.
Stormtrooper, medium-sized, very relaxed. In Full Flight, a powerful galloper with a round action. He attacks from the front. Those are the tactics that suit him best. Trying to ride him for speed is a waste of time. He doesn't have any. If you've backed him, you'll want to see him handy, and he could go very well if ridden for stamina.
Jack Jennings, one of the biggest colts in the field. I don't think he looks quite as well this afternoon as he did up at York when he ran third in the Dante. Big individual. He looks certain to be one of the few in the field who's guaranteed to stay.
But that phrase doesn't apply to number 10, Glory of Dancer. He runs like he'll stay, or races as though he'll get the mile and a half this afternoon. but those who examine pedigrees, and it does have an important bearing on whether a horse is likely to get a distance or not, say that there's a big doubt on the dam side of his pedigree. If he does stay, then he's one of the best horses in the field, as his run, his second place at Sandown in the Sandown Classic Trial and his win at York in the Dante Stakes proves.
Well, I've just heard Lester Piggott saying that this is the horse he'd like to ride if he could pull his breeches back on this afternoon. Shaamit hasn't had a run yet so far this season. It's going to be difficult for him to win without that little bit of experience. But looking at him, he certainly looks the part. Maybe, I don't know, just short of a race.
Mystic Knight. He's got rather stirred up during the preliminaries, something he didn't do when he won the classic trial at Lingfield last time, where he handled the strange descent and turns. I say strange, they're obviously peculiar to Epsom as well, so he passed that test really well, but the grade of horses he was competing against was far lower than he meets this afternoon.
Quite interesting, one or two of these horses have just got warmed up since they've done a couple of turns of the paddock. Here's one who's certainly been sweating for the last 15 or 20 minutes. This is Spartan Heartbeat. Got plenty to find on the book. He's one of two Clive Britton runners, but really, he's a rank outsider.
Maybe you wouldn't use the word rank about a Chardonnay, but he's certainly an outsider based on his last two performances. Did win a nice prize on the first Saturday of the current flat season, but that was on very soft ground. He ran on very firm ground at Lingfield in the Derby trial last time, and to put it bluntly, he was well beaten.
This is Dushyanter, a little bit smaller than most of the other runners in this field, but it didn't stop his stable companion Lady Carla winning the Oaks yesterday. Looks a real professional, doing all of his best work in the closing stages of the Dante.
Well, we're here to try and be objective, and you have to say that John and I have seen Al Harith throughout his career, and whilst he's an attractive colt, he looks nowhere near so well in his coat this afternoon as do one or two of the others. On his two-year-old form, he'd have a big chance. On his last performance, where he was fourth in the Guineas, he'd have something of a chance, but you have to say that the one-time favourite looks now just a member of the field rather than perhaps the leading protagonist he promised to be.
Portuguese Lil is the filly, the one filly in the race, and strictly on form she doesn't have much of a chance, but she's been really well turned out for this race this afternoon by David Nichols. Wife Alex rides this filly, and plenty to find, but there might be one or two finish behind her.
Zaforum comes into the outsider category, but he does have stamina and does appear to be improving. He might not be quick enough, well, he almost certainly isn't quick enough to win, but he should run well enough for us to say at the end, well, he wasn't disgraced.
One for the notebook is Double Leaf. Really good looking individual. He's by Sadler's Wells. Just looks a little bit weak to me. Maybe probably a little bit further on into the season or next year you'll see a different horse altogether. Interesting that Michael Stokes always thought an awful lot of him, just been slightly disappointed on what he's shown on the course.
Classic Eagle looks the part and did win a race on his only start as a two-year-old. However, both his performances this season establish him firmly as one of the rank outsiders in the race. Ridden by Alan Mackay, trained by Roger Harris, he represents Classic Bloodstock.
Barry Hills has had the runner-up in this race four times. Busy Flight is one of his two runners here this afternoon. He's got plenty to find strictly on the form, because he's a really nice-looking horse, this. He's just got our pick of the paddock. And that also applies to Barry's other horse, Prince of My Heart, is another one who looks in really good nick.
And there is Prince of My Heart. His form is... I think the summary would be he's second division on form. He's not a rank outsider. He has respectable performances to his name, both last season and this. The worry about him reproducing that form here this afternoon is that there does appear to be a trend in his form credentials that suggests firm ground might not suit him.
One of the out-and-out stayers in the race is St. Maul's, trained by John Dunlop, ridden by Richard Quinn. He's come up against Storm Trooper, and last time out, just found another one too good for him over a mile and a quarter at Goodwood. That was Don Micheletto. And whatever happens, the faster they go this afternoon, he'll be doing most of his best work at the end of the race.
That might not apply to number 19, Tasdid, because there is a doubt as to his stamina. Although he's by the Coronation Cup winner in the wings, he's out of a mare who won over a mile and who so far, her best family credentials are that she is related to the dam of a very good sprinter, Big Shuffle. This is the longest distance he's tackled, and as I say, as regards Tasdid getting it, there has to be a doubt.
Chanteau seems to be coming right just at the right time. Had three runs so far this season, and he won the last of those quite easily at Sandown. That was over a mile and a quarter, just being brought to the boil by John Gosden, and has the added services of Frankie Dettori.
Latest betting on this Vodafone Derby. Dushy Yantor is the clear favourite, a solid favourite too at 9-2. Glory of Dancer at 6-1. Even top of 13-2 chance has shortened up half a point from 7-1. Stormtrooper and Al-Hareth both at 8-1. On 12, Shaamit and Double Leaf. Mystic Knight at 14-1. Showing at 20s, Jack Jennings and St. Moore's. And then at 25s, Chief Contender, Busy Flight and Shantou. Zaforum at 66 from 100s, then on 100s, Prince of My Heart. At 200-1, Classic Eagle, Tasdid, Ashane and Spartan Heartbeat. And Portuguese Lil, the rank outsider, at 500-1.
Having his Olivier Pezier having his first ride ever in the Epsom Derby, but I must say he doesn't seem at all nervous. Frankie Dettori on an outsider for Sheikh Mohammed. He's followed by Mark Birch having his very first ride. Richard Quinn, who's ridden before several times. So has Mick Kinnan, who of course rode Commander-in-Chief. A rather lovely.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Vodafone Derby of 1996, the 29
saddles and ice riders, very elegant indeed on the white horses. That's David Harrison on Chief Contender, a very live outsider with the star on his back. He's followed by Alan Mackay, very much an outsider, Classic Eagle. Lovely, lovely, the side saddle ladies.
Number 2 is El Hart in the colours of
Ashan, very much one of the outsiders, one of Clive Britton's two outsiders. It's never safe to ignore them, but neither has any chance on form. Al Harith, Willie Carson's 28th ride in the Derby. It took Sir Gordon 28 years to win one. He was favourite all winter, but only fourth in the Guineas. How much difference will another half mile make? Dick Hearn's horses aren't running all that well, but he and Willie have already combined to win three derbies. They've got the good wishes riding with them. Number 3 is Busy Flight, one of Barry Hill's two runners. Cash Asmussen having his 10th ride in the Derby. Well beaten behind Glory of Dancer at Sandown, but had good two-year-old form. Related to Further Flight, he carries the same colours, you notice. Shorter stay. That's Chief Contender, another who's certain to stay. He's got the track record over a mile and a half at Salisbury. David Harrison's first ride. Classic Eagle, Alan Mackay's first ride, out of his depth on all known form. Same can almost be said about Double Leaf.
Double Leaf has been beaten by Glory of Dancer twice this season. It was quite badly hampered, it's true, in a slow run race for the Dante. Plenty to find. There's Pat Edery on Dushyanta, quite likely to start favourite. One of Henry Cecil's two runners, of course. Half-brother to Commander-in-Chief, who won the Derby. Another with a real chance, even top. On form, in fact, he's got the best chance, because he finished six lengths in front of Al Hareth in the 2,000 guineas, and is certainly bred to stay the mile and a half. Paul Kellaways, hope, and what a hope. Glory of Dancer and Olivier Peslier, having his first ride, we know, but very cool. And Glory of Dancer, who ran so well in the Dante, with Dushyanta, Jack Jennings, Double Leaf, and Dushyanta all behind him. There is Jack Jennings, one of the biggest, certainly the heaviest horse in the field, but won't be disgraced for Brian McMahon. Prince of My Heart and Brent Thompson, sure to stay, but I'm afraid the form book suggests he'll take too long. Mystic Knight and Kevin Gully won the Lingfield trial, but I beg your pardon, that Prince of My Heart. Mystic Knight won the Lingfield Derby, but no, Shaamit, this is Shaamit, Michael Hills on Shaamit, like Lamtara. This is having only his third run. Chantu and Frankie Dettori and out. The Spartan Heartbeat, one of the rank outsiders. St. Maud's, sure to stay the trip, but might take too long about it. Stormtrooper has been beating Dushyanta in a lot of gallops until one last week when Dushyanta ran better. Now, real outsiders, the four of Dane O'Neill having his first ride. And this is Dane O'Neill on the forum having his... And last of all comes the first lady ever to ride in a derby, Alex Greaves on Portuguese Lille. I wish she had a chance, but she hasn't.
Favourites have won in 216 derbies. Dushyanta very solid at 9-2. We're still waiting for any bookmaker to go 5-1 against it. Then 6-1 Barber won. That brings in even top from 13-2. And Glory of Dancer at 6-1. Al Hareth is very weak, 8-1. The little support now brought it into 15-2 with Stormtrooper an 8-1 chance. Shaamit is tight at 12, out to 14 Double Leaf, and is 25-1 Busy Flight.
The scene very much set here. The horses making their way down the full mile and a half horseshoe, back down towards the Derby start. We'll be back as they approach the tighter end.
Love is in the air, everywhere I look around. Love is in the air, every sight and every sound. And I don't know if I'm being foolish, don't know if I'm being wise, but it's something that I must believe in, and it's there when I look in your eyes.
Celebrate Euro 96 with the Sunday Telegraph tomorrow and get Monday's best-selling quality daily for only 10 pence. Take part. Take the Telegraph for 10 pence.
The one to watch. Out now to rent.
Do you know what your problem is?
Sex and nervousness is my problem.
The American President. Rent the video now.
I feel terrible dragging you out like this.
It's okay.
I love the taste of Nescafe in the morning.
I don't know how to thank you.
Nescafe. The beans, the blend, the taste.
It's called half. And half. An eloquent testament to the simplicity of modern purchase. It's saying you only pay for half, yet you drive an entire brand new Ford today. And this says you don't pay the other half for 2 years, or you return the car. And yet, in between, and so simple, it's brilliant, it's nothing. Huh? Nothing. No interest, no repayments. I love it for its accessibility.
Half and half. Now viewing at your Ford dealer.
We can't allow this to happen.
You what?
What you propose threatens our very existence. Suppose you were to go back and inadvertently kill your own grandfather, changing the course of history. This facility must be terminated.
It's not doing any harm.
You wrote to your brother. I have cracked it, our kid. I can now isolate a single second in time. I'm in control. I needn't worry about me finances again.
With the Vodafone digital network, I'm charged by the second, not the minute. So I'm finally in control of me finances.
The Vodafone network. You were talking about your phone bill.
Yeah, and excuse me, but how could a karaoke machine kill me granddad?
So merry, Preston Mersey.
We'll just have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
Welcome back to Epsom as we close on Derby time with, as tradition, in the club enclosure, the top hats and ladies in their very finest look out across these downs towards where the, this time, 20 Derby winners are filing down the really steep descent towards the start. A packed crowd here. Discussions about the size of the crowd really are academic, it seems to me. The debate, I'm sure, will end up on whether or not the betting turnover actually reached sufficient heights before it switches back to Wednesday, if that is reasoned why. So, we look out this huge stand, look out across towards the start. 20 runners, and we have news of the best turned out award. £250 goes to Andrew Liggins. Andrew Liggins, who looks after Shaamit. Shaamit running for the first time this year, trained by William Haggis. Here they are, walking down. Just one or two jig-jogs there. You've seen the green colours of Jack Jennings, and to the left, Tadid in the second shake. Hamdan colours. Let's get up to date with the betting.
And Dushy Antor is still the market leader at 9-2, but there's money for even top. The Guineas runner-up started out at 7-1, now down to 11-2, and may yet challenge for favouritism. Glory of Dancer at 6-1. Money also for Al Hareth from 8-1 to 7-1. Storm Trooper at 8-1. On 12s, then Shaamit. On 14s, Double Leaf and Mystic Knight. Jack Jennings and St. Moore's both showing at 20-1, along with Chief Contender, who's also a 20-1 chance from 25-1. On 25s, Busy Flight and Shantou, Zaforum at 66-1. At 100s, Prince of My Heart. 200s, then Classic Eagle, Tazdid, Ashane and Spartan Heartbeat, and Portuguese Lil still at 500-1.
As part of promotion this year, the specially commissioned Vodafone Derby Trophy has been taken to all the Derby trials. Indeed, Frankie Dettori has been instrumental, and indeed John McCrick too, in banging the drum to create Derby interest. In America, the Kentucky Derby, which is interestingly enough, is always run on a Saturday, that is really promoted right through the spring of the year. And there's no doubt that the Derby is to re-establish its proper status. It needs to be promoted by the whole racing industry right the way through. And now, latest from the track, the eye-catchers from our team. In the paddock. It was busy flight, an outsider on the form, but making progress and looks best of all in the paddock. Going down, Jack Jennings and Double Leaf moved smoothest, and Chief Contender moved least beautifully. In the ring, interesting enough, Chief Contender has got a lot of support, and so has Stormtrooper, and Al Hareth, the winter favourite all the way through for the Derby, who incidentally I did think cantered down quite beautifully, but Al Hareth is fairly friendly in the betting market.
There is the Derby favourite, Dushentour, and with me now is the man who looks after him, Dave Goodwin. You're going for a record-breaking third Derby success. You've led up to... How does this horse compare with the others?
They've all been totally different horses. The only thing they've had in common is they've all been very good. And I just hope he's as good as the other two.
What sort of signals has he been giving you that he is as good?
I think from York he's gone the right way. Everything he's done it right. And I think the governor just got him spot on for the day.
Now, what's it like for you? You know what it's like to lead a horse up. You know what it's like to come into winners in coach. What's it like for the stable staff on this very special day?
Tense. It doesn't get any easier. You know, I thought it might, but you still get a few butterflies when the time comes.
Do you think he'll win?
I think if he has a clear run, a good run, and a good run through the race, and he's as good as I think he is, I think he'll win.
I hope he runs well for you.
Okay.
Well, the horses now have got down to the start. Quite a few on their way down seem very much on their toes, particularly Ashane of Clive Britton's. Sweating up a bit. Jack Jennings was a bit warm as well. Both Barry Hill's runners look well, but I have to say the pick and who's taking the preliminaries tremendously well is Shaamit. He looks absolutely cool as a cucumber, hasn't broken sweat, and a real credit. I'm not at all surprised he got the best turned out. They're just starting to load now. Well, as the horses go into the stalls, Jim and John, what are your final thoughts?
Well, I agree with you. I'd like to see Shaamit win. It would be great if Willie Haggis could emulate the performance last year of Lamtara, having won a Derby without having a prep race. I was most impressed with the way that Busy Flight looked, improved beyond all recognition for his first run this year. Also Gloria Dancer, an even top. Jim?
I just hope we get a good race, John. I think it's been well said it's the most open Derby we've had for many years. An open Derby, a good winner, and maybe a well-backed one. What news in the ring?
Dushentour, the favourite, out to 5-1. They knocked out the even top, the 13-2, did touch 7. Back to 11-2, but one or two bookmakers are calling 6-1 against it. Six solid Glory of Dancer. Money coming now for Stormtrooper into 7-1. 15-2, Alareth, and his 12-1, Shaamit. Good outsider, Chief Contender. 40-33-1 into 16-1. And Portuguese Lil is 500-1. If she and Alex Greaves took a shortcut, came straight across the downs, she still couldn't win, and she should be 50,000-1.
And so the last of the runners going to be set for this 217th Derby, the Vodafone Derby. Longest winning distance we've had was Shergar, won by 10 lengths. Fastest time, Lantara last year. Glory of Dancer just to go into the stalls. That's going to be one of the last in. Expect the early pace to come from Jack Jennings from stall 4, sure to be up there. But one of the factors of a Derby, there's not only the stiff uphill climb for the first half mile, but the relentless pace from the start to the finish. About 2.5 minutes. Walking forward now, Spartan Heartbeat. As we hear, there are just 3 more to load. Jack Jennings just lashing out down at the start. He's going into stall 7. Starter Simon Morant signalling 1 to go. And so they kick away then with a mile and a half in front of them. A little bit slow to stride was Classic Eagle and Spartan Heartbeat, the outsiders. Moores takes a good early position. So too Stormtrooper Wide and Jack Jennings, and also in a good position is Glory of Dancer. Not that far away is Al Hareth and Double Leaf racing fast, and Dushentour sitting midfield. And it's Jack Jennings that tows them around the first turn. The green jacket the light green jacket in the centre, Jack Jennings under John Reed. Then we've got Stormtrooper, look to the right in the pale yellows, Glory of Dancer, Dushianto just being pushed along by Paladry in about the seventh spot. Following that one through is the four on the inside, even top holds a good position. Chief Contender striding up on the outside, and some scrimmaging there, and Dushianto possibly a sufferer. They go through the first half mile, and it's Jack Jennings out of trouble in front. Busy Flag comes through for second, Mystic Knight sitting well in third. Glory of Dancer holds a beautiful position on the inside. Chief Contender out wide. The Stripe Cap of Al Hareth racing well. Then Stormtroopers and Moors. Prince of My Heart on the outside. Dushian to the inner. Then comes Shaamit and Shantua. Shani is well down the pack. So they come down towards the halfway stage. And it's still Jack Jennings running the rail. Busy Flight. Red Cap, Mystic Knight. Yellow colours pushed along Chief Contender. The second rank on the inside. Glory of Dancer travelling well. Then Even Top just taken back a bit. Al Hareth behind these. Then on the outside, St. Moore's Tasted tries to go forward. Stormtrooper's going to come wide. Ashan is well down the pack. Spartan Heartbeat is last of all. Portuguese Lille is well down the pack as they begin the descent to Tattenham Corner. Still Jack Jennings and Mystic Knight one and two, with Chief Contender sitting wide on the track third. On the inside, the yellow is the Glory of Dancer, then Al Hareth. Then behind these comes Portuguese Lille, belying a 500-to-1 chance. Then St. Moore's and Even Top finding the turn a little bit hard to handle. Dushianta's well down the pack. Stormtroopers on the outside. Shaamit's travelling well on the outer, but down the straight they come. And the green colours, it's Jack Jennings next to the rails. Here comes Glory of Dancer. Red Cap, Mystic Knight. Yellow colours, Chief Contender. Here's Shaamit, the pink colours, with a late sweep on the outside of Al Hareth. They've got a quarter of a mile to go, and it's Shaamit who's come through to come and take the Vodafone Derby. He goes into the lead. Glory of Dancer in second. Then comes Jack Jennings, followed by Chief Contender. Shantu and Dushianto picking up wide on the track. But Shaamit going for home. They're inside the final furlong now. And Shaamit has the answers too clear. Here comes Dushianto and Shantu out wide. Then Glory of Dancer. But Shaamit is going to be pressed hard by Dushianto. But at the line, Shaamit wins it to Dushianto in second. And then Shantu. A photo for fourth place between Glory of Dancer and Al Hareth. And then Mystic Knight and Jack Jennings. And Ashani, then Double Leaf and Tasted and Classic Eagle, then Chief Contender and Even Top and Spartan Heartbeats are for him, then Stormtrooper and St. Moore's and Busy Flight and Portuguese Lille, and last of all was Prince of My Heart. Would you believe it? The whole Derby structure is being rewritten. Last year, Lamtara, we hadn't seen that horse before. He'd only won a couple of races at two, and this time we hadn't seen Shaamit before. But the Newmarket vibes were good. Lester Piggott, no less, told us that his son-in-law was going to train the winner if he wanted to have a ride in the raid in the race. That was going to be on number 14. Shaamit, in the colours of Mr. Khalifa Dasmel, trained at Newmarket by Willie Haggis and ridden by Michael Hill. Second horse home is number 8, Dushianto. Pat Edery didn't get the best of runs in the Khalid Abdullah jacket on the outside. Third horse home, why, that's number 15, Shantu, ridden by Frankie Dettori, Sheikh Mohammed's runner. And the fourth horse is number 10, Glory of Dancer. What a triumph for Newmarket, but particularly what a triumph for Willie Haggis, Michael Hills, and the whole Haggis combination, winning it with Shaamit.
Well, a wonderful training performance this from Willie Haggis. He's kept cool right the way up until the time of the race. He knew that he had a big chance. Didn't want to just overplay his hand. And this horse certainly hasn't let him down. Travelled well throughout the race. They were a little bit apprehensive about whether they were going to get into traffic problems. They must have talked this race through 10 times. And you can just see how pleased these two are. Nice to see them showing their emotions. Willie Haggis always got a ready smile on his face, and it'll be a few weeks before that disappears, I'm sure.
Congratulations there from David Nichols to Michael Hills. And in a fascinating race, you saw two contrasting horses. Shaamit with a tremendous turn of speed to take the race by the scruff of the neck and then hang on grimly as the runner-up Dushianto, in trouble from the word go, probably inexperienced, almost certainly lack of initial pace, and he provided the thrust late on that made sure it really was a race. Well, you don't see too many smiles. He's often accused of having a face like a well-kept grave, but today, well, not even he can resist. Wife Susan They've been through so much together, and he looks more pleased than on any of the occasions he won himself. And no surprise to see Michael Hills elated, apart from the fact that it's the biggest moment in his career. He's been very close here at Epsom a couple of times. And John, you were never a nearly man as a jockey, but you must have come close a couple of times in races and wondered, would you ever do it? And Michael Hills, okay, he's mid-30s now, been riding in the Derby for a number of years. Looked like he'd win it a couple of times before. It didn't happen. It has now.
Well, that'd be a big relief. Well, not a big relief to him, I should think. Not a relief that he's actually won the Derby. I think a relief that it's all gone more or less to plan. He looked really nervous beforehand when I saw him walk in the course. Not very often that you see him like that. His father, Barry, has come close to winning this race on any number of occasions. He'll be just as thrilled to see his son here in the winner's enclosure.
For the second successive year, a horse unraced to the three-year-old wins the Derby. The applause welling round the stands now for Shaamit, returned 12-1, clear sixth favourite. Lamptara last year and the only other this century unraced the three-year-old to win the Derby was Grand Parade way back in 1919. The runner-up Dushyantor sent off the 9-2 favourite. Third was Shantou at 25-1 for Dottori, who was runner-up last year on Tamor. And fourth, Glory of Dancer, 6-1.
And Michael Hills. Now, let's not forget the one that did all of the work, Shaamit, because that's an incredible achievement to come here and win this race. A, not having had a race yet so far this season, but B, just so inexperienced. Just about the trickiest course in the country. He's come here, not put a foot wrong. Rightly looking quite pleased with himself. Can we get out? It makes it hard for all these six stay-at-home punters when we've had all the trials and 2 years running. We've got a horse come through. There's somebody there looks as though they're anxious to get themselves kicked. Quite often think when they get crowded into this winner's enclosure, they just tend to cramp the horse, giving them quite enough space for them to wander around. But 2 years running, without having a chance to have a look at them.
Yeah, well, that makes it, as Jenny Pittman said, the glorious uncertainty about the game. If it was all easy, which it certainly hasn't been for you or I today, there'd be no point in turning up. But I just can't get away from the involvement of Lester Piggott in this. I mean, the man retires, he comes back, he retires again, and yet right at the forefront of Epsom here this afternoon, and Channel 4 provided a tape of the last 20 derbies for William Haggas, who went through them with Leicester earlier this week.
Well, this horse is getting very excited here, and look, he's giving the horse a kiss, and why not? Khalifa bin Dasmal, who I think has been the most nervous man. I've got his racing manager here, Dave, as well. That was something, wasn't it, David?
Brilliant.
Absolutely.
Brilliant.
When did you tell us about this horse?
You, 3 months ago.
3 months ago.
3 months ago.
Brilliant.
I said the horse will be a champion. Khalifa. He will be a champion. He'll be better from here, believe me.
What was that like?
It's wonderful. Yeah. I never expected to win the Derby. Mm. I was hoping for a listed race, let alone the Derby.
Yes.
To have three horses in training.
Yes.
And to win the Derby.
Yes.
Well, this is fantastic.
Khabiba, I know it's very exciting here. Yeah. Tell us about your background. You come from Dubai. Tell us how you got involved with the racing scene here.
Layla. How should I? I mean, I've always loved horses, and I have been into horses quite a long time.
Yeah.
And then, of course, my friends Al Maktoum came along, and Sheikh Mohammed and Sheikh.
Yeah. And we've got William Haggis. Congratulations. What's it like winning your first Derby?
Oh, very nice.
Is that a
good horse? He is a very good horse.
That is something. Be honest. Come on. I know you fancied the horse. Did you really think he'd win?
Yeah.
Did you?
I did. I mean, he's galloped. His gallops have been well publicised, but he's galloped all the horses he's been with, he's beat, and they were the favourites. So I thought he could win. Mm. We thought he was fit, need a lot of luck. Mm. They didn't go much gallop, which suited us. He hit the front too soon. Yeah. Otherwise, it was very good. He's a good horse.
The gallops actually were spot on, weren't they?
Yeah, but he's always pleased me. He's a good horse. We're just lucky to have a tool like him, and he doesn't bother.
He's a good trainer.
He's a brilliant trainer. Shaamit means it's Arabic, but it's for the Shaamit, sire and the dam.
Shaamit actually just two names between the sire and the dam.
Yeah.
Mutoto Met and Shumus, the dam. So we thought Shub and Met, Shaamit.
Yes.
But it has a silly meaning anyway.
It has.
Which is a person who gloats on other people's misfortune, but we didn't mean it in that fashion,
no.
Of course.
No.
Gloating.
It means gloating.
It means gloating. Maybe he gloats on the opponents, maybe.
Well, you have every reason to enjoy it. What does this mean to you? How does this feel?
It's unbelievable. It's fantastic. I mean, I can't believe it. I won the Derby.
You won it, Khalifa. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And here's a happy, brilliant man, Michael Hills. He has won the Derby, the sixth attempt. Gore Bridget had to wait 28 attempts.
And I know how it was. God, amazing feeling. I mean, it's just unbelievable. The last 100 yards was the longest 100 yards of my life.
And tell us, you very nearly didn't get here because you were on the deck when you were riding this morning. Tell us about that.
Well, if I start off, there was a thunderstorm last night and it knocked off the power. So I was meant to meet William Haggis at 20 past six. I was still in bed, fast asleep. He rang me, which prompted me to get up for Jeff Bragg at quarter two. I went down the gallops, the horse whipped round and I'm on the floor, sitting, had a mile to walk home.
And you survived that?
I survived.
Now tell us about the race itself, because you had a very inexperienced horse. I have a brilliant, very inexperienced. Yeah. How did the race run for you?
Well, he broke well and he's got natural speed, which is great because I could hold a position. But it was a very rough race. I managed to keep him where I was because I was going so well. I followed even top nearly the whole way through, got onto Al Harb's tail. I spoke to Lester yesterday and he said to me, keep to the inside. I broke that rule and he said, don't try and make ground down Tattenham Corner. So I sat and waited to the straight and he took off.
It just looked for a moment as if he weren't handling Tattenham Corner very well.
If I had done anything on him at that stage, he wouldn't have handled it. So I just sat on him, you know. And I come round. Where am I? There I am. I knew now he's going to run a big race.
You knew then he was going to run big? Did you think he was going to run as big as this?
I knew he'd get me there. I just hoped that the last two furlongs he wouldn't see him out without a race, you see. That's what frightened me. I got here, I'm getting confident now. What a feeling. He just drifted in, but he quick and clear of the others.
You've gone through, your trainer said you've gone too soon.
Well, he probably did. I tell you what, I bet his heart was pumping now.
Well, you won it clear, they are closing, but not that much.
And what was second, Deshanti?
Deshanti second and Shantu third.
All right.
Now, Michael, tell us, you've ridden this horse all the way through. You rode him first time out, he was fourth, he then won at Doncaster.
Yeah.
Haven't run since.
Yeah.
Did you rate him at Doncaster as a Derby winner?
Oh, I rated two horses I rode last year as very, you know, high-class Group 1 horses. He was one of them. The other fellow went lame. And really, when the other one went away, it was my home. And then I got suspended. So I thought, God, I'm going to miss him in the Danty. And he waited for me, and we got back together.
Now, gallops aren't the same as races, but how well did the gallops go?
He's always worked brilliant. He's always worked good. He's always worked so well, we never had to find out what was on the other end. We came here, and me and Willie never won it before, but we thought we had a big chance.
Your father's a trainer, you've been brought up as a jockey from the cradle, really. How important is this day to you?
Well, it's this day of my life. And I've done it. Amazing. Really is good.
Many more to come.
Thanks
you very,
very much.
So, Michael Hills has won his derby, the 1996 derby, won it with a brilliant horse, clearly, in Shaamit, who's mowed them down, first time out of the season. The presentation ceremony after the break.
Sir, our sources tell us you sent a very interesting email to a colleague at the university.
Aye, that I did.
Quote, she appears at 9 every morning, a beast in the waves. It's hideous. I need help, unquote.
We are that help, sir.
Oh, thank goodness. I'm so cut off here. If it wasn't for the Vodafone digital network being able to send and receive email through my wee laptop here, I'd be stuck here alone with her. I can't stand it much longer.
No worry, sir. We'll clear this up. It's 9 o'clock.
Any second now.
Ah!
Morag, my cleaning lady. Once you get rid of her, you can start with the washing up.
We'll just have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
We never stop watching. SO Price Watch. This Sunday, every Sunday, get Sunday Business. All the business news you need. Conditioning, the Citroen Xantia.
The new Stenoline HSS. Now you can experience jet-powered journeys you thought possible only in the air. The comfort you enjoy in your own home. The leisure facilities you find in an entertainment complex. The quality of staff and choice of food you expect in a hotel. Combined with an unrivaled frequency of service. The new Stenoline. More ships and more sailings on more routes to Ireland, France and the continent than any other line. Stenoline, the next generation of ferry company.
We never stop watching. SO Price Watch.
Back to a place still buzzing with the brilliance we've seen from Shaamit, a horse who was little known in the sense he'd only run twice but very much buzzed about. Before we had the presentation ceremony, a look at how he's bred.
Well, you just wonder where the ability comes from directly. Obviously it's the result of a union between sire and dam. The sire and Toto was a brilliant racehorse himself, a son of Busted, and Toto trained by Alex Stewart, Swahili for little baby, was at his best at 4 and 5, won the Eclipse Stakes on 2 occasions, was always on the cards. He was going to get horses who developed late, but not a great deal of ability. The dam, Shamus, by Habitat, out of a mare called Epithet, but she's a granddaughter of Milreath.
And so now to the ceremonial trophy presentation.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the fanfare signal to start off the presentation of the trophy for this, the 1996 Vodafone Derby. But first, Christopher Spence, chairman of the Epsom Race Committee.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to you to Epsom this afternoon. We've seen another magnificent derby, won by a worthy champion in Shaamit, owned by my Mr. Khalifa Dasmau, trained by William Haggis, son-in-law of none other than the legend of Epsom, Mr. Lester Piggott, and ridden with great skill by Michael Hills. It was a truly magnificent achievement for a horse which had not had a race before this year. Well done to all the connections.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, Sir Ernest Harrison, chairman of the Vodafone Group.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was a tremendous derby for a number of reasons. And we want to congratulate, of course, the winning owner, Khalifa Dasmau. We're so pleased for him. So much into racing, deserves to be a winner, he is, and we're pleased for you. When a smallish trainer wins the derby, you have to be pleased, because this is the romance of racing, which proves that anyone can train, ride, or win the derby. And this is what racing is about. And today we've witnessed Willie Haggis, the first entry in the derby, and he's a winner. Isn't that a wonderful scene to be enjoying? Aren't we pleased for him and his family? And then, of course, the Hills family, who have to be in everything that's in racing, deservedly so. We're so pleased for Michael. A wonderful ride, a wonderful first for him, but his dad, Barry, who's somewhere looking down on this today. Tears in his eyes, I'm sure, but so proud of his son, and indeed sons, who've done so well for racing. We're proud of you, Michael. Great achievement.
Ladies and gentlemen, we now call upon Lady Harrison to present the trophies, beginning with the 1996 Vodafone Derby Trophy, received by Khalifa bin Dasmau.
First, I must thank the sponsors, Vodafone, for their generosity, for that trophy, and for the money as well. Thank you very much. They have done very well to support racing. And I also must thank William Haggis. He is a brilliant trainer. He has a plan in his head. Also Michael Hills, who rode the horse brilliantly. I mustn't forget, of course, the formidable Maureen. William Hills, William Haggis' wife, who has been wonderful, who had solid as a rock, really never doubted the ability of Shaamit. And of course, I must thank all those people who have been working behind the scene at the stable there. Everybody of them, they have worked very hard for this dream to come true. Thank you very much.
And now a presentation of the trophy for the winning trainer, ladies and gentlemen, having first runner in the derby today and a winner, William Haggis.
Thank you.
Your Majesty, ladies and gentlemen, this is a fantastic thrill for me, for my wife, for my staff, for Michael, his wife and his family, and for the owner, Mr. Dasmal, who in the last month has driven me bonkers. This victory would not be possible without the work of so many people, and I'll be here till the last race if I go through them. But thank you to them all, and they know who they are. I'd finally like to thank Sir Ernest and Lady Harrison for their most generous sponsorship. This Epsom Derby is the most wonderful event in the racing world. Thank you.
And finally, ladies and gentlemen, we call upon Lady Harrison to present the trophy to the winning rider. Another first, ladies and gentlemen, for Michael Hill.
His wife, Chrissy Hills, up on the podium with us.
Well, I've been waiting for this for a long time, my whole life. I've managed to achieve it, and I don't think I could thank William Haggis enough. He's done such a wonderful job to get this horse here on the day, fit and well. And his father-in-law, Lester, talked through the race with me yesterday. I'd like to thank him very much. Maureen, who's done a fantastic job keeping me and Willie quiet. I'd just like to thank everybody involved in the horse, and thanks very much to the sponsors, and thank you.
Can we just have a nice group train for
the stewards are holding an inquiry in connection with the second race, which will not affect the placings, I'm sure you'll be delighted to know. Details of the inquiry will follow in due course.
Click, here's confirmation of the full Vodafone Derby SP. First number 14, Shaamit at 12-1. Second number 8, Dushi Yantor, the 9-2 favourite. Third number 15, Shantu at 25-1. And some sporting bookmakers will pay out on the fourth number 10, Glory of Dancer, at 6-1. The totes, the win paid £16.60, so slightly better on the tote than SP. The place is £4.90, £2.80 and £4.60. Dual forecast £36.50 and the straight forecast £57 exactly. Non-runner was number 6, Clever Cliché, 20 ren.
Well, we've discussed the winning story. There were obviously several other stories to dissect and go through. Here's some scrimmaging that took place, one of several rough incidents. Early on, even top, Al Half close together up front. Further back, we have Shantu involved with the Irish challenger Taz did. As this one unfolds, let's see just what's involved here. St. Moore's there, red, white sash, scrubbed along. Then look at Pat Eddery, too, from the rails. He's between Zephorum and Shaamit, the winner, it looks. And Taz did there, and then St. Moore's, and that is a horrendous incident. Really lucky, very, very lucky that none of those horses came down. Of course, it's no quarter asked, no quarter given in racing. Everybody wants a position, but that's the sort of courage, the rough and tumble, the luck in running or ill luck in running that befalls some, goes with some against others. Fortunately, it was no more serious than you've just seen.
I've got Lester Piggott over here now. Lester, come and join us. Just looking there, it seems a very rough race. Was it like that when you used to be winning the derbies?
It's always rough, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It looked there, though, as if Shaamit really got squeezed up. So to come from that position.
Well, when they come back towards the rails up at the mile gate there, you know, there's always a lot of bunching and, you know, argy-bargy there because it can't be helped.
Yeah, yeah.
The fault is really that, you know, that they all go to the other side and then come back again, and they all want a good position. And that's where you always get a lot of, bunching up there.
It's not an easy race to ride it. What sort of advice did you give to Michael Hills? Because I remember that you got a tape of the past 20 derbies and you sat down and went through it with him.
Well, we thought beforehand that the horse would show plenty of speed through the race, because he's always seems to be going well wherever he goes. So we thought it would be quite easy, really. We thought he'd always be up there, and then he'd just come there in the straight, easy, and come away. It didn't quite work out like that, but nearly.
It nearly did. He got in a good position coming around Tattenham Corner, and he got himself clear of trouble.
Yes, and he just when he did ask him in the straight, he just shot there, didn't he?
And he did. Yeah. Deschantour was possibly unlucky of Fess finishing second.
Yeah, he had quite a lot to do once he got clear. But, this is a good horse, no?
It is, yeah. And how much satisfaction does this give you? You know what it's like riding them home. What about it when your son and daughter train the winner?
It was unbelievable, really, because, the horse... We wanted a horse to have a race beforehand, and it was impossible, He didn't have one setback, he had quite a few, enough to keep him from running all through the year up to now. And I suppose it hadn't mattered much in the end, because he was good enough to overcome all that,
A wonderful performance, wasn't it?
Oh, terrific, But we always knew he was good, He was always done everything right in that,
And what about you? What's it like for you?
No, I think, it's marvellous for him, not me, but for him it's marvellous, really. Because, he had the confidence to wait anyway,
Which is good.
I think a lot of trainers would have rushed and run in some little place or Goodwood or whatever, when it wasn't necessary, So it's marvellous,
Let's have a chat with Michael's wife, Chrissy Hills. What's it like being the wife of the man who's just ridden the winner of the Derby?
Exciting.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, it's very exciting. And it's very much a dream come true, not just for Michael, but for the whole team, everybody that's involved in the horse. I mean, it's just unbelievable. What can I say? Very, very much unbelievable.
Where did you watch the race from? And did you see that he was coming through?
I watched the race from just outside the jockey's weighing room. And as soon as he hit the front, I just thought, yes, he's got a one. I was very, very excited then.
Did you do what Australians do and sort of get quite vociferous in the closing stages?
Definitely, yes, yes. The people about me certainly knew I was there anyway.
Oh, lovely. How difficult has it been? Because I know you've been fancying this horse for quite a few weeks now. Has it been getting a little bit edgy? What's it been like in the Hills household the past few days?
Very tense, I would... Yes, tense is a very good word to use here. It's very difficult because Michael, he keeps his feelings very much bottled up inside of him, and it's sort of like, hi darling, how are you, what are you doing talking to me sort of thing, so it is very, it's very tense, but then again, I mean, he was very laid back on the way to the races, as I was, and it was only when I spoke to Willie Jarvis that I started to get nervous.
Well, he makes everybody nervous,
yes,
doesn't he?
Yes, quite.
Now, celebrations tonight, I believe you've all got to know, where is it going to be held?
Well, I've got no idea at the moment, but Michael, we've got to leave here shortly and go back because he's riding at Newmarket this evening.
Of course, yeah. But there will be a good celebration.
There definitely will be a celebration in Newmarket somewhere this evening,
And you might be buying some champagne, I understand.
I think you'll be there, won't you?
I'm definitely going to be there. You're on. Well done, you two.
Thank you very
much. Congratulations.
Bye now.
Thanks.
Well, I have to say I'm absolutely delighted with the result because I sit talking to William Haggis every morning on the Heath, and a good time we had too. Lots of jokes. Brilliant for them. But there were, of course, the ones who finished behind and not so very far behind. Frankie Dettori said that basically 2.5 at home, both he and Pat Eddery were following Shantou. They were only a length down, he said, but then all of a sudden Shantou kicked and put an awful lot of daylight between the other horses. He said no real excuses. He was delighted with the way his horse had run on, but he said the winner, and indeed he does, as it shows there, had that tremendous acceleration which makes a Derby winner so very special. Pat Eddery is now in with the stewards. We assume four possible misuse or overuse of the whip. That is still to be decided. Frankie and Pat, obviously, you've got to ride for your life in the Derby. They're chasing this horse, but all they can do is chase. And both Pat and Frankie said, no real hard luck stories. What happened may have cost me a length, but it certainly didn't mean I'd have beaten the winner.
Now, a news from Doncaster, the 2 o'clock result. First number five, Greek Night Out at 6-1. Second number one, Royal Expression, the 11-8 favourite. And third number seven, Great Oration at 10-1, nine rand. The 250, subject to a steward's inquiry. First number five, Capilano Princess at 9-1. Second number one, Mushahid at 100-30. And third number three, Marigliano, the 5-2 favourite, seven rand. Haydock, the 210, first number 11, Victorian Style at 3-1, second number 4, How Long at 5-1, and third number 5, Parsis at 14-1, number 8, Unitas, the 11-4 favourite there, 11 rand.
And this is the sire of the Derby winner, Shaamit. This is Mtoto, and he's still a fine stamp of horse. What wonderful moments he gave Michael Roberts. Two eclipses, second in the arc. Had a chronic foot problem as a young horse. Alex Stewart trained him brilliantly, and he was one of the stars of the late 80s.
Now latest from Haydock, the 255. First number one, Pleasant Surprise at 9-2. Second number six, Exalted at 20-1. And third number 11, Sandy Floss, the 4-1 favourite. A non-runner there, number four, and 11 ran.
So take a deep breath and face the Derby trip again, but this apprentice's moment of glory for them to take their audition over a Derby trip, because there are 13 runners here. There's a 12th runner, plenty of people watching here. They're all trying to work, make sense of the Derby. What the sense was that Leicester had it right beforehand, but coming down towards the start are the 13 runners for the Patent Apprentice Handicap, because number 12, Western Playboy, is out. Here's the full list from Graham.
And our top weight is to Cedele de Passage, and that's ridden by Colin Monday, and it's a 33-1 chance. Dancer Sweet 6-1, David O'Neill, Ben Fleet 15-2, David Griffiths, Samalek 33-1, Peter Murphy, Arctic Courier 13-2, Tony Whelan, Casual Water 8-1, Stephen Down, Toy Princess 14-1, Jamie Gotobed, then 14 Global Dancer 12-1, Danny Salt, Rising Clover 11-2 favorite, Alan Daly rides, Ma Petite Anglaise 10-1, Robert Havlin. Country Lover is ridden by Amy Cook, 7-1 chance. Country Lover is visored, normally is. Patafe is 8-1, Mark Baird and Achilles Heel, 15-1 chance. And that's ridden by Martin Dwyer. Getting down to the start for the Packnet Tote Direct Apprentice Handicap.
And before we get to that race, Paul Kellaway. Woke early this morning with the Derby dream. You had it. For a long part of the race, everything went very well, but not quite well enough, Paul.
No, he just didn't seem to get the trip. Mm. You know, the breeding said he might not. And the horse got very tight now. He's tough, and he's got very tight, and he was really on the bridle all the way. He gave him a great ride. I mean, 12 and a half out, he was the winner. He didn't get home. Not that worried, because he's got some good races in him.
And all the worries about Olivier, that some people said, not you, that Olivier Pellier wouldn't be able to handle Epsom, or the horse wouldn't handle Epsom, that was kicked right out of the window.
Of course, yeah. I mean, he gave him a great ride. But, I mean, the horse was on the bridle, and it does help. And he might have just burned a bit too much gas being on the bridle. But then you've got to be on the bridle to be there. I mean, Grand Prix de Paris, the York race, things like that, you know.
Champion Stakes,
you name it, he'll be there.
Yes, Breeders' Cups.
Arlington Million.
That's a mile and a quarter, Arlington Million.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a win.
Not beaten. Yes. Not beaten yet.
Paul, thank you for this morning and thank you for this afternoon.
Thank
it was
you
a
very much.
Great race.
Thank you for your help.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Now back to the 3:10 latest betting here. The runners at the start. Roy's and Clover, the 11-2 favourite. Dance So Sweet at 6-1. Arctic Courier at 13-2. Country Lovel is a 7-1 chance on 15-2 Ben Fleet, 8-1 Casual Water and Hatter Fay. And then at 10s Ma Petite Anglaise, Global Dancer on 12-1. Toy Princess is a 14-1 chance. 33-1 Zamalek and Celle Le Passage. And Achilles Heel is the 50-1 outside.
So, the eye catchers on this occasion in the paddock, Ma Petite Anglaise, on the course Zamalek, and not Toy Princess. In the betting ring, lots of money for Dance So Sweet, and there doesn't appear to be any for Roisin Clover. Let's take the one first that they put their money on, Dance So Sweet, a gelding by Sharif Dancer, made a winning reappearance at Newbury, where the ground was considerably easier than is the case this afternoon. O'Neills are making the name in racing at the minute. Dane O'Neill is one of our leading apprentices. David is one of our most promising, and he rides this horse. And we're looking at Roisin Clover, chestnut mare, who also made a winning reappearance, now ridden by Alan Daly, finished strongly to beat General Mukhtar at Kempton on April 29th, so been off for a few weeks, but if she's still in the same form, would go well here, because not badly handicapped.
Ready to go.
Our ambient sound mics there, you can hear one of the horses got very restive in the stalls. Yet find out who it is. Just one more to go in, that would be Celle Le Passage, the latest betting. Roisin Clover 11-2, 6-1 Dance So Sweet. Here's Graham.
And a little bit slow to stride was Achilles Heel. That's lost a length or so out of the stalls. Celle Le Passage showing up prominently in Dance So Sweet and Casual Water. And then behind these is Ma Petite Anglaise in a good position. On the outside of the pack, Hatter Fay, the pace looks steady. Toy Princess shuffling along out the back. And Achilles Heel is towards the back. To Arctic Courier near at last. First, Roisin Clover is settled midfield as they make this first dogleg turn. And on the right, in the yellow with the blue stripe, that's Dance So Sweet. The green cap is Ma Petite Anglaise. And look further left in yellow and blue, that's Hatter Fay. And then in the red and black, Global Dancer taking a keen tug. That's up for the leaders too. So they go through the first half mile in this Packnet Tote Direct Apprentice Handicap. And it's Global Dancer that's come through to take up the running. To Hatter Fay on the outside, Dance So Sweet runs the rail. Great thrill for this apprentices on the Derby Day to have a race over the complete course and distance. At this stage, Zamalek is towards the back, and the black and white at the back, Benfleet, look towards the rail at the back. That's Achilles Heel. Global Dancer, though, in the red and black leads from Hatter Fay in second place. Then Ma Petite Anglaise, and next to the rails, Dance So Sweet. Toy Princess on the outside, Roisin Clover in the yellow with the green cap, sitting about three lengths off the pace. That's with the red sleeves, Roisin Clover. Behind these, a Country Lover trying to get a bit closer. Celle Le Passage behind that. They're at the top of the hill, freewheeling down to Tattenham Corner. And it's Global Dancer and Hatter Fay who share the work. On the outside is Roisin Clover. Very wide is a Toy Princess in yellow and orange and brown. Dance So Sweet still runs the rail, and then the Casual Water starts to pick up. Arctic Courier getting a little bit closer. Country Lover behind these. Celle Le Passage. Zamalek is still towards the back. Benfleet nearer last and first as they start the turn in. Round Tattenham Corner they come. Top of the home straight now. And it's Hatter Fay on the outside of Global Dancer 1 and 2. Roisin Clover with a red sleeve jacket. Dance So Sweet moving well. Then Country Lover, Casual Water. Arctic Courier starts to pick up. Achilles Heel tries to come with a run from the back. They've got a quarter of a mile to go. And it's Hatter Fay that's gone into the lead. But here comes Dance So Sweet next to the rails. These are 1 and 2. Country Lover, Casual Water, Roisin Clover and Arctic Courier all playing for places. They're inside the final furlong now. And it's Dance So Sweet on the far side under young David O'Neill, who's taken a length out of the pack and is going to take this. It's Dance So Sweet striding on. Dance So Sweet from Hatter Fay. Here comes Achilles Heel, but it's Dance So Sweet, Achilles Heel, Hatter Fay 1, 2 and 3. Then Arctic Courier, Casual Water, and behind that one came Ma Petite Anglaise, and these are followed by Benfleet and Field Trail back to Zamalek, who was last of all. And so the result then of this, the Packnet Tote Direct Apprentice Handicap, 6-1 chance, Dance So Sweet has won. That's number 2 on the card, and the colours of Sir J.S. Guckian, trained
by Paul Cole and ridden by young David O'Neill, who had an allowance due to the conditions of this race. And well did he ride Dance So Sweet. Second horse home is number 14, Achilles Heel, slow to stride, but came home well in the colours of Camelot Racing, Martin Dwyer on board. Third horse home is number 13, Hatterfay, and Mark Bairn had that one in the firing line virtually throughout. The record books will show you that Arctic Courier was fourth, but here comes our winner in the yellow and blue colours, some way wide of the rail. That's the striped sleeve jacket of Dance So Sweet. The yellow and blue colours with the blue epaulettes is Hatterfay, and these fill the principal places. But look further left in the dark blue and orange, that's Achilles Heel, who finishes with a rare flourish after a slow start. But things have gone, the cards have fallen right for Dance So Sweet and David O'Neill.
A quiet betting heat, but Dance So Sweet returned the 6-1 clear second favourite and beats Hatterfay, sent off at 8-1 with Achilles Heel, double carpet twice, 66-1 Achilles Heel. The Dance So Sweet was favourite for some time, went out, but late support for it as a bit of easing came in Roy's in Clover, sent off the 11-2 favourite at Roy's in Clover, but 6-1 Dance So Sweet. Quite popular with those who bother to have a punt in the boys' race. And they absolutely correctly that Achilles Heel was second. My apologies for that. The caption was correct. Achilles Heel second, double carpet twice, 66-1. Hatterfay third at 8-1. And there is a steward's inquiry. Just announced, a steward's inquiry.
Right, let's take a look at this head-on and see just exactly what the stewards are looking into. Side on, David O'Neill had a look before he switched towards his inside. Certainly didn't appear to hamper anything, so maybe it was one of the runners emerging from the pack who got into a bit of trouble. And we're going from 3.5 furlongs out. Maybe there was a bit of scrimmaging there. And up front, we have Ma Petite Anglaise, Hatterfay just taking over the running now. Hatterfay with the yellow armless blue sleeves. Mark Baird, he's in charge there. You see David O'Neill in yellow colours having a look behind him. Certainly some scrimmaging further out. Country Lover and Casual Water. Country Lover jockey in orange colours. Casual Water jockey in red colours got close together. And further behind there, as Ma Petite Anglaise weakens, yellow, blue sleeves, green cap, that one has definitely been squeezed up. And that might be what they're looking at. There's an incident there, not a serious one. We've discussed already Casual Water and Country Lover. We look at Achilles Heel on the outside, dark blue colours, orange hoop sleeves. He runs on, but once again, Casual Water edging in, and that is what the trouble is there. The Roisin Clovers jockey, Alan Daly, nearly out of the saddle there as he goes back. And whether it was careless riding, whether it was deliberate, or whether it was just one of those things, they'll be sorting out in there. But the winner, John, definitely not affected.
Absolutely not. I think it was just Rocky Forum. Not Rocky Forum, we were talking about. It was Arctic Courier, who was just unusually drifting uphill there. And Dance So Sweet. Just being upset by something there. Anyway, the steward's inquiry doesn't affect either of the first three. And I'm very pleased Henry Ponsonby there, who's got an interest in the winner. Confirmation now from Simon.
Yes, subject to the steward's inquiry. First number 2, Dance So Sweet at 6-1. Second number 14, Achilles Heel at 66-1. And third number 13, Hatterfay at 8-1. Non-runner number 12, number 9, Roisin Clover, the 11-2 favourite, 13 rep. Now a result from Worcester on the 3 o'clock. First number 7, Valisky at 12-1. Second number 6, High Post at 10-1. And third number 1, Winberg at 8-1. Number 11, Spanish Blaze, the 2-1 favourite there, 15 rep.
A vision out of the mouth of a tuba,
the stewards' inquiry continuing. And they're saying that it's to do with the events in the final furlong, as we heard. And don't forget the inquiry into possible, and it's pretty poorly done to say, possible excessive use of the whip. We had this after the 2,000 guineas in the Derby. That's continuing too. News of that and everything else after the break.
Okay, I want pastrami on Bavarian rye, sweet pickle, tomato. Easy on the Dijon, kosher dill and salt.
Excuse me, double decaf, hazelnut latte, medium roasted Colombian beans, 2%.
Sirloin, hobi, coffee, jack cheese, lettuce, jack tomatoes, cheese, capers, and Russian dressing. Fresh parmesan and oregano to go.
The new Chrysler Neon, built for the most demanding country in the world.
Ma'am, we understand you're in touch with people from the other side.
Di! Di! Put these away for me, Di.
Is it true you're in touch with the other side?
Oh, yes. Old Mrs. Jones, Seven's the post. They may be in a faraway place now, but that's no problem for me.
Can you demonstrate your ability to contact the others?
If you like.
You use a mobile phone?
Oh, yes. With the Vodafone digital network, you see, I can easily reach people on the other side. Or Festiniog, Betrisacoid, Llanfair, Pwllgwyngyr, Gwger, Chwindrobyll, Llantysilio, Gogogoch, all over the place. Gwynedd, I have a couple of funny city folk here. Could you have a word?
I guess we'll have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
New from Lynx Skin System. A daily moisturiser for men. Because life can be tough on your skin. Use it after shaving and help protect your face. Lynx System Moisturiser, the art of skin defence.
John Smith's extra smooth bitter slips down like a penguin through a trap door.
His stewards are very busy here. There's three apprentices in at the moment. Then Pat Edery is going in. It's only Pat Edery for possible excessive use of the whip in the Derby on Dushyantor. And then Henry Cecil has to appear before the stewards because Richard Hughes was declared to ride Clever Cliché in the race, even though in fact he was booked to ride in Ireland. That's in the papers this morning, but again, we'll have to be official action, like official action taken over that. A lot of big races coming up. Now we get to this point in the calendar, you then look ahead to the Irish Derby. May Shaamit go on to that. To the Coral Eclipse Stakes. There's no reason why the speed he showed, he might not run in that. And the Glory of Dance, you've heard from Paul Kellaway, he's going to be tilting for all the top mile and a quarter horses. Then we go on to the July meeting at Newmarket, the Darley sponsored July Cup. Really top sprinters there. Maybe horses will come back from the horses who ran in the 2,000 guineas, who didn't quite get the trip, will go back down to six furlongs. Then into August, the Jadmonte International, the Aston Upthorpe Yorkshire Oaks and the Nunthorpe Stakes. There's three glorious days up there on the Naismire. And of course, moving on in Yorkshire, the Pertemps St Leger, the final classic of the season, is on the 14th of September. And incidentally, the winning time here, 2:35.05. Quite rapid all the same. It's the 12th fastest in the Derby history, or since electrical timing anyway, which is the only timing that counts. Nearly half a second quicker than the Lady Carla did in the Oaks yesterday, so a fairly rapid time, and almost 2 seconds quicker than they took over this same mile and a half in the apprentice race. John Oakes is with us here now. And John, your first reflections on the Derby and the performance by, let's say the successes, but the performance by Shaamit.
Well, tremendous training performance, as has already been said. I mean, Willie Haggis has always said that this horse had a lot of ability, and he's managed to get enough work into him, not only to get him fit here, but to get him sufficiently experienced. Frankie Dettori told me an interesting tale of his ride on the third, which was a total outsider, Shantou. And Frankie says that he came round Tattenham Corner into the straight quite close behind the winner, that he and Pat Edery on Dushanka were close to the winner, and that the winner took six lengths off us in a furlong. Those were Frankie's words. And he says that that was when the Derby was won, and it was won by an exceptional turn of acceleration. And they then, his horse and Dushanka, then stayed on, and as you saw, nearly closed the gap. But it was that acceleration that did it.
Of course, Pat Henry, who had won the Oaks on Lady Colour yesterday, who's 10 times champion jockey, he was desperate to try and get that back there, and he is being accused, we don't yet know the result, of excessive use of the whip. He certainly seems to use it a fair amount from the head-on shot. What do you feel about this? Every top classic we get, we then get the jockeys in for breaking the official instruction, it seems.
Yes, I'm afraid, as I've said so many times, it's boring, really. It is awful that every big race should see infringements of the whip guidelines. And the reason, of course, is that the incentive to win a derby is a very great deal bigger than the penalties which jockeys suffer. I mean, it's very painful to be suspended and expensive to be suspended. But the fact of the matter is that the only penalty which would stop this kind of infringements of the H9 guidelines, the only penalty is disqualification.
And would you do that if you were in charge of the disciplinary committee now?
I don't believe that it's practical. I believe that it would cause too much of a grievance in the racing and betting public. And I further believe that the individual opinions of local stewards and boards of local stewards would vary so much as to what is excessive use of the whip and what is improper use of the whip. They would vary so much that if horses were getting disqualified for those reasons, it would gravely affront the punting public. But this is to say that betting is all important. Of course, we live on betting revenue, and we can't do without punters. So if you aggrieve them enough, you're going to damage racing.
But Pat Edery is trying to work on behalf of punters, you can argue, and why shouldn't he do everything possible to get Dushyanto as close as possible?
Well, that is what people will say, no doubt, that he's trying his hardest to do his best for punters. What the stewards are saying is that what he does and what excessive use of the whip does is to horrify the viewing public, many of whom are soft-hearted
animals. Does it horrify you? Does Pat Henry's ride horrify you?
I wouldn't say quite horrify me. I don't like the idea of horses being beaten. Horses which are, let's face it, trying their best. They're doing their best. It is, to me, a repugnant sight. More repugnant, I admit, jumping when a jumper is tired, to see him getting hit for no reason whatever. I agree that that's more affronting. But no, I don't like the use of the whip. I don't like...
But what's the solution? In one way, what would you do? You're in charge now. We've got a week to solve it. What would you do?
OK, well, I would start with an experiment. I wouldn't allow any use of the whip behind the saddle. I should say that you could have your hand on the whip, you could slap horses down the neck, not hit them down the neck, you could slap them down the neck, you couldn't use it behind the saddle. I believe that it might cause a few slightly different winners, a few horses who need that kind of galvanizing might not win, but who cares? As Monty Roberts says, I mean, if you breed from horses, this is supposed to be selective breeding, shouldn't you breed from the willing ones? Shouldn't you want a derby
winner? Would there be a different result today?
No. No. Absolutely not.
Your case at this stage rests. Thank you very much.
some news from Doncaster on the 250, and there's an amended result there after a steward's inquiry. Capilano Princess was the original winner, but has been demoted to second place. So the winner is now number one, Mushahid, at 100-30. Number five, Capilano Princess, now in second place at 9-1. And third, number three, Marigliano, the 5-2 favourite. Seven ran. Now, where did your money go in this year's Vodafone Derby? We have the complete finishing order for you. Shaamit, we know the winner, Jushyantor in second, Shantu third. Glory of Dancers, we heard from Paul Kellaway, possibly didn't quite stay the trip, in fourth place. Al Hareth finished fifth for Willie Carson and Dick Hearn. In sixth place was Mystic Knight. In seventh, Jack Jennings, who made a lot of the early running. Eighth, Ashane. Ninth, Chief Contender, who was up there for a lot of the way. Tenth, Double Leaf. 11th Classic Eagle, then Tasdid, Even Top, who weakened quite dramatically from halfway, Spartan Heartbeat in 14th, Stormtrooper was disappointing in 15th, then Zephorum, St. Moore's, Busy Flight, and then the Stragglers, Prince of My Heart, and no surprises, Portuguese Lil finished last.
Well, I think they could have said Portuguese Lil was 20th instead of last, but how did it go, Alex?
Well, it was fun, I enjoyed it, so... live to fight another day.
It looked a very rough race. What was it like from your point of view?
I didn't have any trouble out all the way around, so I kept out of everybody's way.
Mm. Did the feeling of riding the Derby fulfil you as much as you thought it would?
Obviously, I mean, it's a great thrill, and I've enjoyed it.
What was your comment after the race, though?
It went quicker than I've ever been for a mile and a half.
Really? Yeah, it's a bit different out there, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
But seriously, how long would it be before we possibly get a lady jockey riding a fancied runner with a very good chance of winning the Derby?
Probably a long time. It's going to be a long time before somebody else rides in it. Yeah. Hopefully not from our point of view, but probably.
But you've been here, you've done it, and you're going to come back?
Yeah.
Now, just quickly, tomorrow, we're racing here on Sunday, it's live Channel 4. You've got a very interesting ride tomorrow, Pride of Pendle. Now, we've seen him a few times. How is he?
She.
Well, this is where I've been going wrong.
No, she's very well. She ran round here before, so she knows the track, so we're hopeful she'll run a good race.
And you fancy a chance of winning?
She's as well as any of them in the race, and she'll run well.
So out of luck today, but you might be hearing the winners tomorrow.
Maybe.
Well done today, and I hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you.
If you had the choice of being here at Epsom for the Derby or watching England play Switzerland at Wembley, where would you be? I'd hope you'd be here with us at Epsom. And one man who did have the choice, Home Secretary Michael Howard, are you glad you came?
I am indeed. It was a close-run thing. I would like to have been at two places at once. But I'm glad I came. It was a great Derby. I didn't back the winner, but I enjoyed it very much.
Apparently Tony Blair, the Labour leader, has gone to Wembley. The Prime Minister hasn't, and you're here.
The Prime Minister's probably watching both at once on television.
And I mentioned the Queen's here as well, so the top people are here.
Well, you've said it.
Now, this is the second Derby on a Saturday since 1953, when, of course, Pinzer beat the Queen's Oriel. Do you think the success of this has proved that it should be a Saturday Derby, or would you prefer to go back to the Wednesday, traditionally?
I think people would want to look at the attendances today and weigh it all up. Today isn't really a proper test, is it? Because there are so many things on elsewhere. And it seems to be a pretty good crowd here, but I don't know what the numbers are. I wouldn't like to have to make the decision.
Another year of experiment, would you say?
Perhaps. I'm a bit of a traditionalist. I have a slight soft spot for the Wednesday, but we'll have to see.
Now, going on to other subjects, Lord Wyatt has been chairman of the Tote for 20 years. You're advertising for his successor. Now, I'm in the frame, but apparently why don't you just take the decision straight away and appoint me?
Ah, well, because Lord Nayland has said that there are all sorts of procedures that we have to go through now. So we have to go through those procedures, and I'm sure we'll have a very good chairman of the Tote in due course.
Well, have you got headhunters out to find out? Two or three names are in the frame already.
It's all going to be advertised, and your application, John, will be considered extremely carefully indeed.
Oh, very politician's answer, Home Secretary. Now, at the Tote lunch in March, Labour's Robin Cook proposed a government deal with the bookmakers. If they put in Tote Direct in the shops and people would bet on the Tote, the government would allow them to bet on the lottery numbers. That seems a good idea.
We don't do government by deals, whether the bookmakers want to put Tote Direct in is something they should decide. Whether bookmakers should be allowed to bet on the lottery is a separate question, quite a complicated question, lots of important issues at stake, and that's got to be decided on its merits and not as part of some deal.
But you're very keen on deregulation.
Yes, we are.
Conservatives are. Yeah. Why don't set the bookmakers free? If you want to bet on the lottery, fine, nothing to do with government to interfere.
Well, one reason might be that a great chunk of the money that's bet on the lottery goes to good causes. and I'm not sure that the bookmakers are offering any deal comparable to that.
So you don't think in time that they'll be able to bet on the lottery numbers, as in Ireland they do, for instance?
Well, it's not something which has been decided, which has been resolved, but I can see difficulties in the way of it. But we're doing a great deal. We're doing a great deal for the bookmakers. As you know, from later this month, they're going to be able to have amusement machines.
If it ends in a tenner in prizes, Home Secretary.
No, that's what they want, two machines in a shop. And again, we've consulted on advertising for bookmakers. The consultation period ended at the end of last month, so I hope we'll be able to make a decision on that soon. And we've been racing right. If you look at what we've done on VAT, on betting duty, across the whole range, we've looked after racing pretty well.
Sunday racing, the betting, of course,
yes,
evening
right.
Opening a betting shop.
That's right.
So once again, setting the industry free and let them make the decisions.
And I think the industry's better off as a result.
Keep the government out of the industry, keep the government out of the country, far as I'm concerned. Not many people will
well,
say
keep
anyway.
The government out of the industry as
certainly.
Far as possible.
Certainly. Now, why can't we have, Home Secretary, a multi-billion pound Las Vegas in Britain? Think of the employment it would bring, the tens of thousands of people who would go there. Why are you stopping it?
Because you have to be very careful about casinos. In other countries, I'm not casting any aspersions on Las Vegas, but in other countries, gaming of that sort has proved to have quite close links with crime. It's an easy way of laundering money, and we have to be very careful about that sort of thing. These are very, very serious issues.
Have you been to Las Vegas?
Yes.
It's fantastic, isn't
I
it?
Have been
well,
there.
Why can't we have a Las
I
Vegas over
it.
Here? It, there you are.
Yeah, but there are these very, very important factors. There's sometimes perhaps too high a price to pay for that sort of thing.
Now, I hope, Home Secretary, like I am, you're eating lots of British beef.
I certainly am.
We are going to win this, aren't we?
We certainly are. We've made it perfectly clear that until we have, well, we've had now the lifting of the breeches ban, we also need to have a framework for the lifting of the ban as a whole, and then we can get back to normal relations.
Keep cracking the British beef, that's what I say, and you agree with
Absolutely.
Me here.
You look as though you've had a very, very, very good portion of it,
well,
a very good helping.
I'm
delighted to see that.
Did you back the Derby winner?
I wish I had. No, I backed the second, who was a half-brother to the last Derby winner I backed, Commander-in-Chief. But I wasn't on the winner.
And give us a tip. It's an easy race, the Coronation Cup. I'm trying to help your election prospects.
Well,
the opposition will say, by tipping in an easy race, you give the nation the winner.
I'll go for Swain.
Swain.
Many people would think I'd be backing Punishment in the Coronation Cup, but no, I'll go for Swain.
We certainly wouldn't think Punishment with the Home Secretary. Swain for the French, though. It's almost as bad, you know.
Probably mean that Punishment would win.
Thank you, Home Secretary.
Thank you.
Winning any big race is teamwork, and I'm sure after the Derby today, William and Mo Haggis won't mind me saying that a linchpin has been Ray McGinn. Ray, you ride the horse every day.
Yeah.
And you told me back in the spring what a good horse he was. Well, he's proved it.
Yeah, he's a star. I mean, he's a fantastic ride. He's relaxed. He's got so much speed when you ask him to pick up. He's improved all the way along, you know, and we had a little setback there. He was off for about 6 days, but fortunately he wasn't lame. It was just a.
And you weren't riding him when that happened, so that was okay.
No, yeah. Yeah.
But we've got the last furlong of the race now. I know you watched it from up on the stand with wife Liz.
That's right.
But,
yeah.
Have a look now. What were you feeling at this point?
Well, I'd lost him. I was watching the race live, and I'd lost him in the race, and all of a sudden he showed that dash of speed that he's got, you know, and I. Well, although I've been confident all along, it's hard to take in once it's happened, you know?
I mean, it's difficult to say where you go next because there's so many options, but...
Well, the thing is with this horse, I think he could win from 7 up to a mile and a half, so it's...
Sign of a really good horse.
He is class.
And obviously, I mean, he obviously handled Epsom better than a lot of the others.
He's the best balanced horse I've ever sat on. I mean, he'd turn on a sixpence, he cruises, he's got such a good cruising speed, and... He's a starter ride. You relax him, switch him off, and when you press the button, he picks up for you.
You don't ride as much now in races as you did, but I mean, riding him every day, is it the same thrill?
Oh, yeah, it's fantastic.
And you are, I know you're virtually teetotal, but you're going to have a drink tonight?
Yeah, I think we'll celebrate tonight. Yes, yeah.
Well done, you deserve it.
Yeah, thanks very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Now news from Doncaster, the 3:20, first number 5 Almazi at 4-1, second number 1 Palo Blanco beaten a short head in second at 9-2, and third number 7 Premium Gift at 14-1. Number 4 It's Academic, the 11-4 favourite there, 9 ran. Piggott, the 330, first number 8, Bolin Frank, the 11-4 favourite, second number 1, Moving Arrow, at 13-2, and third number 3, Queen's Consul, at 6-1, 9 ring. Worcester, the 330, first number 5, Sartorius, at 10-1, second number 3, Polden Pride, at 7-2, and third number 8, Henley Regatta, at 20-1, number 2, Muscora, the 7-4 market leader, 10 rand.
I remember a horse called Sartorius about 30 years ago. Names come around again, and so does the Royal Standard come to Epsom. We'll be back for our next.
Was the West Indies World Cup collapse linked to their young people's newfound love of basketball? What chance do we have in the European Championships when many of our best players can never put on an England shirt? And does technology in Formula One mean there's no such thing as best driver anymore? Only best car? These are changing times in the world of sport. Don't just look on, look forward.
He's discriminated against because he's a victim of crime. He's discriminated against because he drives a powerful car. For an open-minded view of car insurance, call Swinton on 0800 600 700 now. Free air conditioning, the Citroën Xantia.
Our contact should be here by now. Run the details by me again.
Tending to avoid the public, these creatures can act aggressively when confronted. Descending from the mountains at night, they plague the alpine ski resorts with a behavior that can only be classified as abominable.
All right! There's been another sighting. A big one.
How do you know?
Me Vodafone recall. One of my colleagues makes a sighting, he leaves a message on the Vodafone. When I turn it on, he lets me know.
And you can make calls in 37 countries.
Useful.
Useful? Vital, mate. These blights can turn up anywhere. France, Italy, Peckham. Vodafone helps me keep track of things.
Tell me, is it true the Yeti is basically a shy creature?
How should I know? I just photograph celebrities for the Sunday papers, mate.
I guess we'll have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone Network. You are not alone.
Welcome back to the packed Epsom Downs as the next race approaches. And meanwhile, the result stands on the 310. The winner there, number 2, Dance So Sweet at 6-1, survives the steward's inquiry. Second number 14, Achilles Heel at 66-1. Third number 13, Hatter Fay at 8-1. The totes there, the win paid £6.10, places 270, 660 and £2 exactly. The dual forecast £146.50. The straight forecast £242.86. And the tricast £2,901.17. Non-runner number 12, number 9, Royston Clover, the 11-2 favourite. Result stands 13 ran.
Best time. So now the Racing Channel handicap. It's over a mile and a quarter, and there's already a best turned out award. £100 goes to Sean Coates, who does number 4, Ho Express, for Ian Bawley. Looked absolutely outstanding in the paddock. Ho Express wins the £100 best turned out award. There are 16 of them to launch around Tattenham Corner. Here's Graham.
And the top weight is a course and distance winner, that's Ella Aristocratia, 14-1 chance with Philip Robinson. Marilyn Linger ran in the Derby last year, 14-1 chance, Paul Eddery. Ellie Yardensky at 14-1, Neil Varney claiming 3. Ho Express, Amanda Frankie de Tory trades in the ring at 8-1. Stone Ridge, who's ridden by the top apprentice of the season so far, Dane O'Neill. He claims a £3 allowance, 14-1, the odds on offer. Hardy Dancer, 7-1, Simon Whitworth. Dariabad, 33-1, Richard Quinn. Tersham, 13-2, Tony Whelan claiming 3. Pinkerton's Pal is 25-1, Mark Baird with a £5 allowance. Hugwitty the favourite, 11-4 with Willie Carson. Dane Gold, Vither, 25-1, Alan Mackay. Wakil, 14-1, Alan Daly with a £5 allowance. Hazard a Guess is ridden by John Bramhill. Note the jockey change, £7 allowance on this 7-1 chance. Field Ridge, 20-1, Martin Dwyer claiming 5. Conspicuous, 20-1, Jimmy Quinn. Zerma, 20-1, Dick Adams. That's the lineup. It's the Racing Channel handicap, and the runners are arriving down at the start. So, let's see what caught the eye. In the paddock, it was Field Ridge going down. Difficult to spit Tersham and Dangold. Both moved down with a lot of fluency. Dariabab was very stiff joint going down to the start, didn't look as if he'll handle the track. In the betting ring, Hugwitty comes in support. The Carson factor possibly a contributory factor there, although the horse does have improving form. And Tersham is drifting badly in the market. Went down to the post well, though.
Well, I was interested to see that Dariabad didn't go down too well, looked magnificent in the paddock. But Hugwitty, favourite here, started the season on a really good handicap mark. Big horse for a four-year-old, he's done nothing but improve. Won over a mile and a quarter at Chester, dropped back in distance, and still scrambled home at Goodwood last time out. Looks to have an excellent chance here again, Jim.
Yeah, the only doubt, and it's something we're not sure of, is John said he wears bandages and it's heavy top horse, whether he'll handle this very firm ground, but if he does, he beat a horse in Green Perfume who absolutely danced in last week at Lingfield. He must go well. Now, this is an important horse here, 13, because a lot of form students will have been fancying this morning and backed off it because Alex Greaves, the stable jockey, was in all the papers as being down to ride. And they'll have backed off because Alex's minimum riding weight is 8.3, and most punters would have been expecting 5 or 6 pounds overweight. But in point of fact, John Bramhill, a very good northern-based apprentice, takes the ride, and he's good value for his claim. This horse comes late and has a chance.
Tersham is the mount of Tony Whelan, and he's in decent form, this horse. He's already a winner at Beverley this year, where he won quite nicely last time out up at Redcar. He didn't get the best of runs. He's a horse who likes to come late, met a little bit of trouble in running and still ran a fine race, wasn't beaten too far, had another of today's runners, Pinkerton's Pal, behind him, but that was a reasonable handicap performance.
He's been equipped with a tongue strap on his last two starts and improved considerably since that was applied.
Like Hugwitty, he's quite a heavy topped horse. How Express is a horse who's always been something of a favourite of mine. I watched him run in the Horace Hill last year, and he's been quite highly tried this year. The form's worked out, finished behind Blomberg at Sandown. Saw that one scoot up in a listed race yesterday. Might
John,
just be coming to himself.
Sorry to interrupt you, I just wondered, he's a horse you've seen more than me. I wonder, just looking at the bare facts of his form and not having seen him much, whether you think he's effective on the ground.
I think he goes all right. He's quite lightly made. He's admittedly, the day that he was third in the Horace Hill, it was plenty of give in the ground. But I've watched him run well, you know, when it's fastish. And as I said earlier, there's no real excuses for horses this afternoon. It's a good, fast racing surface. Plenty of cover, but there's some late betting news from Simon.
And Hugwitty, the favourite at 11-4 from 100-30. Sevens, Tersham, Hardy Dancer and Hazard a Guess. They're just about set now. Here's Gigi.
Race away then for the Racing Channel handicap, and it's uphill through the first quarter mile here. Hugwitty holding a position. Zermatt striding through with confidence to take up the running. And Hazard a Guess is the back marker. Aristocrati last but one, Field Ridge last but two, as they stride through the first quarter mile and come to the top of the hill then. And Pinkerton's Power running free the inside, the yellow jacket of Zermatt, 1 and 2. Maralinga White on the course shares third with Eli Ardensky and Hugwitty. And just in behind these, we've got Hardy Dancer in a prominent position. Then behind these, Tersham, and on the inside, Dariabad. And behind that one is Ho Express with Dane Gold well down the course at this stage. Wakil sits midfield. Pinkerton's power, the yellow colours though, just has the edge to Zermatt. Then the dark blue cap on the outside, Maralinga, that's the 1-2-3. Spotted cap, the rail, Hugwitty. Pink cap, Eli Ardensky. Stance leaves, Hardy Dancer. Check jacket, Tersham just goes out of shot as they begin the descent to Tattenham Corner. The back marker is Ella Aristocrati and has it a guess last but one. A Dane Gold striding through on the outside, Ho Express and Fieldridge towards the back two. Dariah Bad starts to make a little bit of ground as they begin the descent to Tattenham Corner, and it's Pinkerton's pal and Mark Bird who runs the rail and just has the edge to Zermatt, these one and two. Then comes Eli Ardensky, or Maralingo and Eli Ardensky, three and four. Hugwitty, the favourite, being ridden along by Willie Carson. Just didn't handle that downhill descent, did he? The big horse who's heavily bandaged today. Down the straight they come. They've got under 3 furlongs to go now. Zermatt into the lead with Pinkerton's pal. Here comes Hardy Dancer with the star sleeves. Maralinga striding forward. Duryabab with a run. Conspicuous picks up. Tersham on the outside. Ho Express with a rush. Zermatt fades. Eli Ardensky still there. 1.5 to go. And it's Tersham on the wide outside that goes for home in the lead. Hardy Dancer, conspicuous. Eli Ardensky starts to pick up there. Maralinga, Ho Express could get placed. It's Tersham in the lead as they stride inside the final furlong. Tersham in the lead, but here comes Eli Aristocrati from the clouds. Where has this one been? He's going to take it. Eli Aristocrati, Tersham 1 and 2. Ho Express 3, conspicuous 4. Then came Hazard, I guess, running on through beaten horses. Then Eli Ardensky and Hardy Dancer and Fieldridge and Maralinga, and then Wakil and the field trail back to Hugwitty, who was last of all. Poor old Ben Henry had a horse breakdown at Warwick, and I don't think Hugwitty's come back any too sound. However, at 16-1, Ella Aristocrati has won in the colours of Mr. Andreas Michael, trained at Newmarket by Luca Cumani, and ridden by Philip Robinson, who's 14th winner of the season. It is second horse home, that's number 8, Tersham, looked all over the winner till it was swamped in the last 50 yards by an amazing run by Ella Aristocrati, who's passed virtually all the horses in the home straight. Third horse home for me was number 4, Ho Express. That one in the colours of DF Alport, ridden by Ian Balding, trained by Ian Balding and ridden by Frankie Dorian. I think we'll find that the fourth horse home was conspicuous, and Jimmy Quinn. So our winner is the top weight, Ella Aristocrati, who's come from virtually last to first to mow down Tersham in the closing stages. The 14th winner of the season for the men on board, Philip Robinson.
Well, he didn't collect with even top, but he's given this horse a fantastic ride, Ella Aristocrati. Last, with only 3 furlongs to run. He just began to weave through horses as they began to die in front of them. He was able to weave his way through. He came through from the inside to the outside, back through to the inside again. Was lengthening all the time. And you've got to feel slightly sorry for Tony Weedham. Did nothing wrong on Tersham, had him in the right place, looked all over the winner until about 15 or 20 yards from the post, and then saw victory snatched away.
And here's the SP. First number 1, Ella Aristocrati at 16-1. Second number 8, Tersham at 7-1. Third number 4, Ho Express at 8-1. And fourth number 15, Conspicuous at 20-1. Number 10, Hugwitty, the 11-4 favourite, 16 ran.
Philip Robinson, as John said, it's really put the disappointment at even top way behind him. A real peach of a ride there, because it is a desperately difficult camber to ride here, and at the grave risk of disagreeing with my noble friend John Oakley, I think that's the example of being able to get a proper crack in, a proper good whack, really just made that horse quicken. Just a crack on the shoulder wouldn't have been enough, but differences of opinion, certainly a great ride there by Philip Robinson. Comes through here. He's won classics, of course, with Pebbles and with Bob's Return. Thought today he could do it with even top. But it wasn't to be, but he's won here. We'll be back.
This summer, thanks to Vauxhall's 50-50 offer, you can have 2 years free from monthly repayments and 0% interest. Just pay half now and half in 2 years. Alternatively, the windfall payment plan requires just a 20% deposit. They'll pay your first 4 monthly repayments, leaving you with 4 free months. hopefully. Take advantage of Vauxhall this summer. Don't pay them.
Sir, our sources tell us you sent a very interesting email to a colleague at the university.
Aye, that I did.
Quote, she appears at 9 every morning, a beast in the waves. It's hideous. I need help, unquote.
We are that help, sir.
Oh, thank goodness. I'm so cut off here. If it wasn't for the Vodafone digital network being able to send and receive email through my wee laptop here, I'd be stuck here alone with her. I can't stand it much longer.
Don't worry, sir. We'll clear this up. It's 9 o'clock.
Any second now.
Ah! Morag, my cleaning lady. Once you get rid of her, you can start with the washing up.
We'll just have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
Buy any pair of spectacles for $69.99 or more at Dolland & Acheson, the opticians, and we'll give you a stylish pair of prescription sunglasses absolutely free. A sight more value, a shade more style at Dolland & Acheson, the opticians.
Nice to have the family here, and Andreas Michael owns this. And who's this you've got with you?
This is Marius.
Hello, Marius.
Hello.
Hello, and how old are you?
4.
A difficult one, that. Yeah. Hey, Mum, how are
Hello.
You?
All right, thank you. Very pleased.
I bet
he
you
showed.
Are.
He showed what he is.
He's a real aristocrat.
Yes.
What does it mean, aristocratic?
Come, my aristocrat.
Oh, yeah.
Come, my aristocrat.
A tour, coming, my aristocrat. Here he is, Philip, come round.
He is the next aristocrat.
He's the next aristocrat. Lord Robinson, I think. Yeah. Hey, that was good. You came from a long way back there.
Yeah. Well, they went very fast, which suited me, because this horse can run a bit keen.
Yeah.
But he switched off, and he was doing it nicely. And when they go that fast, there's nothing really quickens from up front.
Mm.
They would maybe keep going, so if you can save a bit and finish up that hill, you've got a chance.
You've got a chance, but let's have a look round here. Come and have a look at the monitor.
I was worried here from nowhere. I thought we were going to get nowhere here.
Nowhere. Now, where are you? Where are you, Phil?
Well,
that you rode the back on the inside?
Yeah.
You've got no chance.
Last one.
Yeah. Here. That's you there.
No chance.
Now, tell us through. Now, you've got stacked horse in front.
I've got a lot of horse under me.
So what is your job now?
I'm just weaving my way through and looking for the right one to go and beat. At this stage now, I can just start. I've worked out which horses I've got to go and follow.
Yeah.
Mr. Kamani said try and pick the right ones to get them and take them on up the straight.
Look, a nice gap there.
Yeah, and they've all just opened up nicely, and my horse really stride out the last hill.
But you really had to go from here.
Oh, yeah, but when you've got a bit of horse under you like that, they can respond, you know.
That was lovely,
easy.
That.
Very easy.
Yeah.
Very easy.
What was that like, watching that?
Yeah. Very pleased.
Yeah.
Very happy. And Luca is not here.
Yeah.
And we're very pleased, and I'm sure he see it now on the television.
Yeah.
And we just take it from there, the next step.
We're very
pleased Philly brought the horse.
Yeah.
Because Philly rode the horse before 3 times.
Yeah.
He ran very well.
Yeah.
And always I was insisted, Philip, to ride him because he know the horse.
Well, that is good, and it makes a difference.
We're busy sometimes. We got it right today. Anyway, I've got a dash.
All right.
I've got new Philip, market.
Just quickly.
Thank you very much.
Even top, before you go, top, what do you thought?
A bit disappointed. He got struck into about the 5 pole.
Yeah.
I was travelling okay, but wasn't really happy coming down the hill.
Yeah.
And I think, because the horse come back under me a little bit, I think something ran up behind me and took my heels away, and just a little gash on his back leg, which obviously didn't help.
Yeah.
And he was never really happy.
Yeah.
But, he lived to fight another day. He's a very exceptionally good horse.
Yeah.
And, he'll come out and prove himself. Just today, wasn't it?
We'll see you in Newmarket tonight. Well done. Now, come on, I've got to talk to you because
I'm just very pleased.
Okay.
Well, how do you look after this horse? You come up from London, don't you, quite often?
We spend a lot of time with this horse.
Yeah.
And even with other horses, we travel nearly every week.
Yeah.
Because this year we knew this horse should run very well.
Yeah.
And I've been watching this horse all the time. We had the last run in Sandown where we was very disappointed. This it was the no aristocratic run the run, and I still determined for that to say it, and that's why I was very upset. I mean, with Michael we was very pleased. We was very happy with him.
With Michael, yeah, because
we had a very good relationship. Yeah. I still expecting he's a nice man.
Yeah.
But I wasn't agree that race to go my horse is Sundown.
Yeah.
And I asked him not to run in the horse, and he insisted to run in it, and I was very unhappy about
that. These things happen. But I know when you do have a winner, you like to give the winning trainer and the jockey a nice bit of steak, don't you?
Of course, of course. Yeah. Keep their fit.
Now, what about the steak business at the moment? I mean, with all this scare, how difficult has it been for you both?
We're not involved much in steaks.
Yeah.
Not much in steaks, and it does affect everybody, this the beef scare.
Yeah.
But we still have to fight back.
Do you have a shop or what? Tell us.
We're wholesalers.
You're wholesalers?
We meet wholesalers, yes.
And you go out there and get packing up the meat?
No, not me. Housewife. I've got four.
You've got four?
Yeah.
Cool. Well, you've lost. Well, I've got one here.
Yeah.
Any more kids around?
Four I've got.
You've got four. Well, I can see one, so you're going to have a busy afternoon. Well done on
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
See you again.
Lovely to talk to you again.
Thank you very much.
You're on.
Thank you.
See ya.
Bye-bye.
Now the totes on that last race here at Epsom. First number one, Ella Aristocrati at 16-1. Second number eight, Tersham at 7-1. Third number four, Ho Express at 8-1. And fourth number 15, Conspicuous at 20-1. The win tote, £18.80. Places 350, 240, 170 and 470. The dual forecast, £85 exactly. Straight forecast, £117.60. And the tricast, £894.91. Number 10, Hugwitty, the well-beaten 11-4 favourite, 16 ran. And now at Doncaster, the 355, first number 5, We Hope at 9-4, second number 6, MI Coasting, the 6-4 favourite, and third number 10, Time to Tango at 4-1. The win tote there was £2.50, places 130, 130 again, and £1.20. The dual forecast, £2.60, and the straight forecast, £6.34. A non-runner there, number 4, wasn't such a We Hope, was it? 9 ran.
Well, it's Derby Day, it's a big day out for most people, and of course it's an excuse to dress up, and they did just that today. All ages, shapes, sizes and colours, fashion statements all. That's it.
Extraordinarily bad news, really, when the bookmakers say they've had a very good result on the Vodafone Derby, and they're all saying that, both Ladbrokes and Hills. Hills say a very pleasing result, Ladbrokes a very good result. They're saying virtually unbacked in the shops was the winner, Shaamit. And some of the complaining about the each way at Shantou, Frankie Dettori was third. And the bookmakers, of course, who went each way, 1, 2, 3, 4, Glory of Dancer. That was a particularly bad result for the Glory of Dancer, finishing fourth at 6-1. Now, if you backed each way Glory of Dancer, I bet you wish you'd come to Epsom each way tax-free. Instead of doing your money, you'd have won some by getting on that Glory of Dancer returned at 6-1. But it is still extraordinary, isn't it, that statistic of the Dante. Four horses beaten in the Dante, ran in the Derby, Jack Jennings, Dushy Antor, Double Leaf, and of course my own Stormtrooper. They sent out search parties to go and find Stormtrooper. That got lost completely. It now means that all 76 horses who have been beaten in the Dante to come on and run in the Derby have also failed at Epsom. We're now getting an awful trend of horses not running in the trials at all, turning up here and winning the Derby. They've done it 2 years running. Shaamit has done it, and of course Lam Tara, and back to 1919 Grand Parade. So good news for the bookmakers, not for the punters. What's been happening down at Worcester?
Well, a winner there for Richard Dunwoody, Mac. First number 8, Phalarope, the 9-4 favourite. Second number 4, Call the Governor at 6-1. And third number 3, Boltrose at 16-1. 12 round.
Out on the hill, and that's where the great attraction for so many people on Derby Day is, there's more than 250 members of the Channel 4 Punters Club. And they brought a couple of buses here. They're having a terrific time over there. They've probably more than two buses. And it's really a great club to join. People of like mind who love their racing. Great time to have a gossip and have a bit of a punt together and enjoy yourselves. And of course, it costs only £6 to join. You get £5 tote voucher back straight away for dual forecast on the tote. And they got their own horse, this Mirror for Life. These two won at Nottingham for Mark Tompkins not so long ago, and it could run at Bath on Saturday, that Mirror for Life. So great fun joining the Channel 4 Punters Club, and if you want to join, this is the address. It's 1 Canada Square, 1 Canada Square, Canary Wharf, P.O. Box 4020, London E14 5BW. So it's Canada Square, Canary Wharf, P.O. Box 4020, London E14 5BW, and on Channel 4 Teletext, page 335 on the Teletext. And we've got the show coming in now on the Coronation Cup. It's 11-10, Tip's favourite Swain, 6-4 against Singspiel, 4-1 to Quest, and 14 punishment, it has been 16-1. So 11-10 favourite Swain to give Andre Farber his fifth Coronation Cup, and he's also got De Quest. But what a disappointing Coronation Cup this is. It's been run since 1902, 49 favourites and 19 runnings this century, including 7 of the last 11, and 21 times there have been only 3 or 4 runners. It's now 22. How disappointing, especially for our friends, the Channel 4 Punters Club, out on the hill.
I thought his arm had got frozen at that stage. But a band is playing up there, and the gentleman on Tomo's coach, I think, may well not see the trip out terribly well. Going at a tremendous gallop at the moment, but whether they're feeling quite so good by tomorrow morning, I rather doubt. Let's take news from Haydock.
This is the result of the big race there today, the John of Gaunt Stakes. And if Michael Hills is the hero of Epsom this afternoon, his twin brother Richard has won the big race there on number 1, Inzar, at 7-2. So well done, Richard Hills. Second number 4, Branston Abbey, the 100-30 favourite. Branston Abbey, a recent winner at Newmarket, and just missing out today. And third number 5, Caronita, at 7-1. A non-runner there was number 7, High Nod, and 9 ran.
And some important first reflections on the Derby Day turnover, which I believe is what's going to be the key to this argument about Saturday and Wednesday. We first had news that the on-course tote turnover was down, fractionally down. And a quote from Ladbrokes here, the Derby Day turnover, they said they're very pleased with the football turnover today, taking many thousands of bets on Euro 96 and indeed in the championship overall. However, says Ian Wassell of Ladbrokes, betting on the Derby and the day's other racing has been disappointing and remains under pressure when in competition with other major sporting events. Turnover on the Derby, he goes on, has fallen year on year. This is in line with horse races' betting performance for the year to date, which, due to the quality of the fixture programme, continues to lose ground against other betting products. So a resounding initial thumbs down from the biggest betting chain, Ladbrokes, on the idea of continuing with the Derby on the Saturday.
Well, they, by the sight of them, John, they didn't back any of the winners this afternoon. They look as though they're just about ready to go home.
Yeah, still got another two or three races left yet. And if they're not looking quite so happy as they, maybe they might. These children certainly been having a good time. Got a fun fair and all sorts of things going. and he looks just like he's run into a spider's web or something. Really ought to be at a football match, maybe.
Yeah.
But whatever.
If he goes up to the hill where Brough was a minute or two ago, he'll see some of the same ilk, I think.
Certainly Hankey wouldn't have come out of been out of place. But it's been perfect conditions this afternoon. Maybe not quite as sunny as you would have wanted, but certainly much more comfortable than it was yesterday.
Don't know why he wants a pair of binoculars when he's got the young lady opposite him that he has.
Yeah, the grass is always greener. And, certainly the case here.
They say a hat rounds off an outfit, or sometimes covers a multitude of sins, or sometimes just keeps the sun off.
Deep discussion. It doesn't look as though it's about the form of the next race, the runners for which are just being mounted in the paddock shortly to make their way down out onto the course.
A race very short on quantity, one can say really strong on quality. That is the problem with the older horses races. There aren't that many top ones to go round, and they don't all come into competition with each other. But four runners here for the Coronation Cup, on after this.
We can't allow this to happen.
You what?
What you propose threatens our very existence. Suppose you were to go back and inadvertently kill your own grandfather, changing the course of history. This facility must be terminated.
It's not doing any harm.
You wrote to your brother. I have cracked it, our kid. I can now isolate a single second in time. I'm in control. I needn't worry about me finances again.
With the Vodafone digital network, I'm charged by the second, not the minute. So I'm finally in control of me finances.
The Vodafone network. You were talking about your phone bill.
Yeah, and excuse me, but how could a karaoke machine kill me granddad? So merry,
Preston Mersey. We'll just have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
I take tea, my dear. I like my toast on the side. But you can hear it in my accent when I talk. I wear English, not in New York. I'm an alien.
Whatever's going on outside, you'll always feel really good inside.
I think it's all over. It is now.
The new Rover 200.
The one to watch. Out now to rent.
You know what your problem is.
Sex and nervousness is my problem.
The American President. Rent the video now.
What puts the core in your korma? Makes an Italian seriously saucy. A soup simply super. And is delicious straight from the pot. Biopot Natural Yogurt by Onken. A natural choice.
Celebrate Euro 96 with the Sunday Telegraph tomorrow and get Monday's best-selling quality daily for only 10 pence. Take part. Take the Telegraph for 10 pence.
Out on the track for this, the Vodafone Coronation Cup. Group one, more than £100,000 for the winner, and only four in it, but four good ones. The firstly, De Quest, Pat Edery. Pat Edery, who's still to see the stewards about the possible excessive use within the derby, and the same colours of Duchianto. De Quest, who's had the one run this year. Then punishment from Clive Britton will be a big outsider here. Richard Quinn in the saddle, just walking through in the parade, as they have for both the Oaks and the Derby here. They do a circle in front of the stands. Singspiel, very strongly fancied by the Stout team. They're delighted with his progress from 3 to 4, and Michael Kinnan is on board here today. He's in the second colours of Sheikh Mohammed, i.e. the white cap, but you wouldn't want to necessarily say Swain was favoured, but Swain, a really high-powered horse who was third to Lamtara, remember, in the Arc de Triomphe, and has Frankie Dettori in the plate this afternoon. Just a bit jumpy by Rainbow Quest, who of course Pat won the Archon on the disqualification in their same Khalid Abdullah silks. Attractive horse, slightly short, choppy stride, and once again they have to do the full mile and a half hack down. So there's a brief look at them, but let's have now the official list of the runners for this, the Vodafone Coronation Cup.
Between them, won over £600,000 in win and place prize money. So no slouches at 7-2, De Quest, Paladery. 14-1, punishment, Richard Quinn. 15-8, Singspiel and Michael Kinnan. It's a 2-1 chance now. The favourite is Swain, 6-5. Frankie Dettori's mount. They're going down to the start. And Andre Farber's first runners in England so far this year. That's De Quest and Sway.
Two French horses in this, and Janet Slade, who's born in England but rides for the Paris Turf. Now, what about the French? They've monopolised this in recent years.
Well, I think if you win it a fifth time, it's going to be the André Fabre Cup, isn't it, rather than the Coronation Cup.
Well, he's won it, so he's won it for the past 2 years. Now, yes. What chance here? He's got two horses, De Quest and Swain. Tell us about those two.
Well, Swain's a lovely horse. He ran up a fantastic series last year, ran a blinder in the Arc, being third, came back in the Gannet. The distance was a bit short for him, but he really did run well, and I can't see why he wouldn't, why he would be beaten, you know.
He's a lovely horse. We had a look at him in the parade ring, and there he is cantering down in the first colours. That's the horse just on the left of those, and he's a lovely horse. You were telling me that André Farb had a problem with the cold weather over in France.
Yes, apparently he got the horses going well, and then they had a bit of a setback with the virus and colds and so on, and he lost out of about 3 weeks' work. So he's been a bit slow starting this year, but he's making up for it all right.
I mean, he still carries a bit of condition, this horse, but he looks spot on, does he?
Yes, he looks really well.
Now, what about the horse behind him in the Abdallah colours, De Quest, with Pat Edry on board?
That's right. Yes, we thought it was Olivier Pellier who was going to ride him. In fact, I think Olivier thought he was going to ride it until the last minute. De Quest is less exposed, I think, than Swain, but he ran very, very well last year, won a Group 2, the Prix Conseil de Paris. Did quite well finishing 4th for his comeback race, which he obviously needed, and he should run well. He should run well.
Tactics could play an important part here. I mean, if they go no pace, I mean, would that trouble the French?
I wouldn't have thought so.
They're used to it over there.
Well, we have so many races with no pace, don't we? You know, they can come off a slow pace and sprint.
Yeah. So, which one's it going to be?
Oh, Swain.
Without a doubt?
Without a doubt.
Swain to win it for France? You heard it first here. Thank you, Janet.
Swain is tops with the punters as well at 6-5 against from 11-10. Singspiel is on the drift from 6-4 out to 2-1. De Quest at 7-2, in half a point from 4-1, and Punishment the outsider at 14-1.
Well, Swain heads the market, and he heads the eye-catchers board in the paddock, on the course, in the betting ring. And negatives Singspiel, about whom there were adverse rumours. I'm not a great believer in rumour mongering myself, but certainly someone in the press room was saying with some degree of certainty before racing that this horse had a setback early in the week. We'll soon know whether that's true.
quite a fascinating race tactically, only four runners, Jim.
Absolutely. Singspiel actually went on much sooner than is usually the case when he was successful on his reappearance over a mile and a quarter at Sandown. And he really deserved to win another group race because he campaigned against the best all last season. Very game horse. He's on the left. The jockey, Michael Kinnan, with a white cap. And I know Michael Stout thinks an awful lot of this horse. He's been a good servant to the stable. And his record of 10 wins, 10 runs, 3 wins and £38,000 in win prize money doesn't really bear testimony to an overall record that has seen him compete against some of the best in the country.
Yeah, he put up a tremendous run last year in the Great Voltigeur, and he just got touched off by Pentire. And he's loose. There was a little bit of a form line through here, horse of Clive Britton's. He's got some sort of a line through his runner punishment, but so too has Michael Stout, who had a runner over in France in Sacrament, actually beat punishment earlier on in the month over at Deauville. So a couple of these trainers obviously fancy their chances here. I just thought, looking at them beforehand, Jim, that this other horse of Andre Farb's, although he didn't actually look to be enjoying the ground, enjoying the ground going down there, he took all the preliminaries really well.
Which one, John?
That's De Quest.
No, well, actually, I disagree with you, because I thought he looked wonderfully well, and he didn't, it's true, he didn't boil over, but I thought a couple of times he threatened to. In the paddock, for a time, he was so lethargic, he almost stumbled. As soon as Pat got on him, he was jig-jogging, and it's worth pointing out to viewers at home, he's a full brother to a horse with a problem or two as regards his riding, and that's Source of Light. Just look there, John. Don't you think he's... I mean, they're only hacking, and he, of course he's keen and fresh, but don't, he doesn't give you the impression he might not be the most straightforward of rides.
Well, it's probably the case. I think that he'd be much happier if they go a good gallop, but I'm not totally certain what's going to take them along. Maybe Pat will just say, right, OK, I'll bowl along. Maybe he'll settle better. It's not really that he doesn't settle. He just doesn't actually... just throws his head around a lot.
Number four is Swain, who, as Janet Slade told you, ran up a fantastic sequence last year for Andre Farb, and those early wins in a five straight sequence were all over a mile and three quarters. So when you bear that in mind, and also recount the fact that he was third over a mile and a quarter on fast ground on his reappearance, underlines what a versatile horse he is at the highest level. And surely, I mean, it's not for me to tell Connections what to do. If there's no pace, this horse clearly stays. It's pointless mucking around, so to speak.
It also settles well. As I was saying earlier, I'd Luso in front of him when he made his comeback, just in front of him, and Valinar just in front of that. So, you know, Andre Farb said that he needed that run. Well, there's plenty of horses that win first time out. He needed to have come on from that run if he's going to be the good thing that he looks. Just about to load up. Get some late news from Mac.
I reckon France are going to win their 19th Coronation Cup, with Swain is now into 11-10, or De Quest into 7-2. Singspiel is desperate. Out, right out now to 9-4 from 11-8 and 6-4. 16 the rag. Singspiel won't win the Coronation Cup, they say down here.
He added lately. So this is it then, the Vodafone Coronation Cup. Now, Swain, Frankie Dettori is going on. Why not? The horse is enjoying himself, isn't he? Going up the hill, pricking his ears and giving a lead to Singspiel in second place. Punishment sitting third. And fourth is De Quest. A little short, shuffling stride on that horse in his slower paces. But it is a steady pace that is being set by Swain, who is guaranteed to see out the trip. Singspiel, the white cap, sitting second. And then in third, we've got Punishment, and fourth of the four is De Quest. And talk about follow my leader, and it's Swain who leads. Frankie just shaking the reins at him to get him interested, and I should imagine the horse is wondering what else is going on here. Has it been down at the start quicker, he says. Singspiel in second place is going to be ridden for speed, as is Punishment in third, and De Quest fourth of the four. Frank and John Franken, what do you do in a situation like this?
Well, it's like an old three-mile chaser, and Frankie Dettori's just given him a slap down the shoulder, told him to pick his feet up a little bit and get on with it. But you could just have a look at the slack in his reins. Frankie's still just giving him a slap at the moment. He's not taking any interest at all, just bowling up, not really sure what's going on. is used to running in Group 1 races, going a decent clip, and as I said, probably thinks he's hacked down to the start and now coming back again.
He is at the top of the hill and halfway in the Vodafone Coronation Cup and still has the edge. And Frankie Dettori looks behind and sees Singspiel the white cap, check cap punishment and pink cap dequest. So normally at this point in a race they start to freewheel, getting a bit of a breather as they begin the descent to Tattenham Corner, but there really hasn't been any pace on at all. Swain has the edge to Singspiel in second and then punishment in third and dequest in fourth place. The horse is a short scratchy stride as they come round Tattenham Corner. Now it's going to be a dash to the line now. Now who can quicken up the best? Swain has it. Now they ride a lot of these races in France, go slow, 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 then rush. So it could well suit Swain this. He still has the edge, but Singspiel is putting in a finish. Punishment and dequest is fourth. They've got just over a quarter of a mile to go. It's going to be a real kick finish this. Mick Kinnan on the outside in the white cap. Frankie Dettori the start cap, going from punishment. Dequest is fourth of the four. They're inside the final furlong with Swain and Singspiel. Stride for stride they are. And as they race up towards the line, Swain and Singspiel still stride for stride, locked in combat. But Swain just going into the lead. He's proving the stronger. And at the line, Swain, Singspiel, 1-2. Very tight for third between Dequest and punishment. And so this Vodafone Coronation Cup, a race of Group 1 status and £150,000 in added prize money, a little bit of a farce really, but the winner is the 11-10 favourite Swain, the colours of Sheikh Mohammed on this homebred son of Derby winner Nashman, ridden by Frankie Dettori, his 44th winner of the season. Second horse home is number 3 Singspiel, that's the mount of Mick Kinnan. And the third horse home, it's a very close call indeed, a very close call between Dequest and punishment. So Swain makes all the running and in the end takes a Group 1 race relatively easily. Frankie Dettori coming home on his 44th winner of the season, successful at Goodwood last night, having a busy time of course, they all are. And what a great race it is for Andre Farber, who's won it in the past with the likes of Santa Steph in the Wings Apple Tree Sunshack, and now adds Swain and Frankie to that score.
Well, it's turned out to be a good race over the last couple of furlongs. Whether they deserved £106,000 for doing it, when you think of those old jumpers going around giving their all at Worcester for 3 miles, these things, I think they do more than a good piece of work at home. Just poodled along in front, Swain just ran away from the rail there. It's just having a look at the policeman and those, the start of the crowd, and now Frankie Dettori's really had to make him go about his work. You just see how much ground he's covering, really long stride. I think at this point maybe McKinnon thought that he just had him covered on Singspiel. He had the horse who picked up quickest of the two, and then by the time they'd gone through a furlong, this horse was really beginning to motor, get his whole body weight in action, and Jim, from here on in, he was always going to win.
Yeah, two good horses, two good jockeys. Michael Canan's got more natural help from his horse than Frankie has. And I thought to keep this big, ungainly horse balanced and running, sprinting, Dettori excelled.
Swain is braver than Singspiel. That decides the contest. Returned 11-10 favourite Swain and gives Frankie Dettori his first Coronation Cup. Singspiel is second, top of the head, 9-4 second favourite. Very, very weak in the betting and desperately tight for third between punishment of 14-1 and Dequest a 7-2 chance. And that's Swain, the 50th favourite in 91 runnings to win the Coronation Cup. The 8th jolly to go in the last 12 years, and others in the 90s were Opera House, Sadler's Hall and In the Wings. And that is the 5th Coronation Cup for Andre Farber after Sunshack last year, Apple Tree in 94, In the Wings in 90 and Saint Estef in 1986, and the 19th French train winner of the Coronation Cup. The market got it right, but really it was the bravery of Swain that decided it.
Well, I must say Mac and I disagree often on this program, and I'm not saying I'm right and his opinion's wrong, but what I would like to say is I couldn't disagree with him more. To me, that is the quintessence of rubbish. Mac, we should point out that neither of us are right about the rumours. The horse ran a brilliant race. He made the race. He was beaten narrowly in a sprint. The horse that won the race had the whip hand throughout. To knock Singspiel in any way is absolute cobblers.
having got that off my collar, Franks. Can you mediate?
Well, I agree with you. You certainly couldn't say that the horse didn't try his utmost. I thought he gave everything. I've never seen him shirk the issue. He's finished second in some very good races, but never once crossed my mind that he was given less than his best. Just got beaten by a better horse. Everything was against Swain, to be fair. He'd have been far happier with a really good gallop. I'm sure he'd have run out an easier winner, as it was. Class has seen him through. First runner in this country for Andre Fabre, first winner Thierry Jarnet, who normally partners the horses over in action in France today. And for Sheikh Mohammed, Chantu ran well enough in the Derby. I think he'd have been quite pleased. I think he'd have been very pleased with the way he ran. And this horse just paying the icing on the cake. Don't look to be anywhere near as many happy faces down there as they were for the Derby, Jim.
They're just not showing it. I'm sure they must be pleased. Let's have a look at Swain's pedigree. He's by Nashwan, and Nashwan, of course, won the Derby in 1989. Many of you will remember that, and one would expect him to be a major influence for middle distance horses at stud. This horse, though, together with one other in America, are probably the only really good ones he's got over a mile and a half plus. And essentially, Nashwan has proved an influence for, he's been mated with relatively speedy mares, and he tends to get horses that run shorter distances well or better than those who stay a mile and a half plus. If you see what I mean.
And here's the SP. First number four, Swain, the 11-10 favourite. Second number three, Singspiel at 9-4. And third number one, DeQuest at 7-2. Four rank.
They just announced the winning time. 2:40.36, that's more than 5 seconds slower than the Derby time. That's almost 100 yards here. A very, very slow race, but the finish is what counts, and Swain did the business. We'll be back.
I've always been very competitive.
Well, I don't want to hear that, do I? At the end of the day, you've got to look after number one to survive.
Yeah, the right car is important to me.
I think that it does impress people.
Money? Nothing to be ashamed of.
If you've got it,
chap, flaunt it. The places you go, the clothes you wear, the people you're seen with, the car you drive.
Well, what do you think?
Nah, it's not really my style. You know what I mean?
Tell Charles I'm on my way. Taxi!
Sir, our sources tell us you sent a very interesting email to a colleague at the university.
Aye, that I did.
Quote, she appears at 9 every morning, a beast in the waves. It's hideous. I need help, unquote.
We are that help, sir.
Oh, thank goodness. I'm so cut off here. If it wasn't for the Vodafone digital network being able to send and receive email through my wee laptop here, I'd be stuck here alone with her. I can't stand it much longer.
No worries, sir. We'll clear this up. It's 9 o'clock.
Any second now. Ah! More Agma cleaning lady. Once you get rid of her, you can start with the washing up.
We'll just have to keep on looking.
The Vodafone network. You are not alone.
Carling Premier. In a world that's losing its head, a lager that doesn't.
photo of the end of the Derby day beginning to come towards us. Her Majesty and the Royal Car lead Epsom Downs, and that feeling of slight letdown at the end of all these helps have been built up and your money's gone, and well, even Her Majesty's money's gone, but it's the end of another Derby day and we're all just that year older, and we'll see if we can try and make it work next year. But it's been a very exciting day. Let's see if you got it right in the Coronation Cup.
There's the totes there. First number four, Sway, in the 11-10 favourite. Singspiel second at 9-4 and Aquest third at 7-2. The winner paid £1.90 on the tote. The draw forecast £1.70 and the straight forecast £3.67. Four out.
Ladies and gentlemen, we come now to the presentation of the trophy for the Coronation Cup, which will be made by Mrs. John Pete, wife of a director of the Vodafone Group. And here, ladies and gentlemen, to receive his trophy, would you please welcome His Highness Sheikh Mohammed. Waiting.
Result from Worcester over the jumps at 4:30. First number three, Brave Patriarch, the even money favourite. Second number seven, Born to Please at 4-1. And third number two, Bramley May at 11-2. 10.
Well, we got some strange looking hats here, but I don't know whether you call that a bodice or what, or whether it's just too big. Just too big to pull it down over, so just left it on her head. Whatever, it's different, I'll give her that. And well, at least you've got somewhere to hang it up if you don't want to wear it. Anyway, I'm not sure whether that was a bit of a result. I think he had a bit of a shock when she turned up with that on. And let's see if there's been a bit of a shock elsewhere, isn't SP?
Not quite. At Doncaster, the 4:35. First number four, Diego, at 3-1. Second number three, Genesis, 4 at 20-1. And third number one, Bayrack, the 15-8 on favourite. Totes there. Win paid £3.50. The draw forecast £27.80 and the straight forecast £25.92.
Four at. Well, he's clutching his bronze and he's just wandering over here now, just round the side. Excuse me, can we just let Frankie come through? You hang on to that. Well done.
Yes, lucky hand.
Yeah, lucky hand. Thank you.
Lucky hands. That was an interesting race.
Yes, it was always going to be tricky with four runners, and I'm very surprised then Andre Frapp told me to go and make the running.
Yeah.
Usually French horses come from behind, but...
It took a furlong longer to run that than the Derby.
Yes, but unfortunately, I couldn't get my horse going any faster because he's never been around Epsom. Mm. And he was running a little bit green in front. I kept slattering down the shoulder.
I noticed, yeah.
Making pick the bridle up, but I didn't. And then he got the run down the hill. And when Mick came to me, he just turned the fifth gear on. And
did he?
I knew I was always going to hold him. He's got a nice fifth gear.
A nice fifth. I noticed he just sort of pricked his ears, didn't he? And he thought, I've got to start racing now.
Yeah. I think his ears pricked all the way around. He made me work hard.
Yeah, but if it's a true run race, how good is this horse?
I think he'd be even better, and a drop of rain won't go amiss.
Yeah.
He's a serious King George candidate at this stage, but I leave the plans to the trainers and owners, but... It's a proper group one horse, and he's entitled to be in all the big races. It just shows you how good Lamtar was last year. He beat him two lengths.
Exactly. So. What about Chantu in the Derby?
He ran a fantastic race. Mm. They went very fast. My horse probably didn't have the experience to lay up handy. And myself and Patty were out the back, but basically we couldn't have gone any faster.
Yeah.
And we had to check a couple of times going down a hill. And when we came into the straight, we switched on the outside and we had Michael right in front of us. Mm. That's about a two and a half marker. But when he pressed the button, he took six lengths out of us.
Really?
It did. You know, when it'd be nice if you're going to show that replay from the head-on, from the top.
From the top, yeah.
And you see that myself and Pat, we're just a length and a half behind Michael, and when he pressed the button, he took six lengths out of us. And in the end, we're staying on and we're catching him up. But he had one gear too much for us.
That's incredible. To take 6 lengths off you and your decent horses. And he was
exactly,
on the Chantour.
It was
how rough a race was it? Or was it just a normal derby race, which is always rough?
Well, the normal rough derby, that's what it is. Of course, it's very rough. Leicester messed things up because he won 9 derbies and it was 5th, one off the rail all the time. Mm. So that's what trainers expect you to do.
Yeah.
So it's 20 horses try to be 5th, one off the rail. Unfortunately, somebody have to be last as well. And the horses with no pace and drop out of the back and getting knocked around a little bit. But usually the best horse comes through and wins.
Mm.
And Shaamit was out the back, travelled on the bridle, quickened like an exceptional horse. And he was the best horse in the race. It was a great performance by Willie Aggies and Michael, and they gave a real horse there.
Well, let's have a look. You asked for it. Now,
yes.
I think we've got it. Now, let's have a look. Oh, here it is, right from the word go. Now, this is the difficult part, because it rises, what, about 150 feet. It's as big as, going up Nelson's Column in Trafalgar Square. Tell us how you're doing it from here.
I'm a little bit off the bridle here, trying to keep my position, and
yeah, you're about, what, 5th last here. Now there's a squeeze as you go right.
That's right, and then from now on it'll get worse and worse. Unfortunately, I didn't have the gears to keep any closer. You can see that I was kind of scrubbing along to keep a good position. And in the same hand, you can see Pat riding along.
Yeah.
And from now on, that's where the derby rough race starts, when everybody gets a little bit tight, a little bit of squeeze. And
this is where it gets nasty there. Oh, there's a lot of scrimmaging there.
As you can see, Pat basically didn't have the gears to keep any closer.
So therefore, if the horse had been good enough, he possibly could have got himself out of trouble.
Exactly, but that's why the derby winner is always a great horse, because they have to have that little bit of kick to stay out of trouble too.
Interesting point. So this time you're still climbing, because you climb for an awful long way.
Yeah.
And there you are in the middle towards the rear.
I've got Michael just in front of me there on the right.
Yeah, so there's the eventual winner, Shaamit, in about 9th place at this stage.
Exactly, and like myself, Pat and Michael, we're all together.
Now, what are you looking to do here?
I'm trying to keep my position.
And you're on the inside there.
Yes.
So there's no way through there. You're going to get boxed here. Now you're down to, last of that leading group. Hall.
Exactly, yes. I'm trying to follow Pat through.
So what are you thinking to yourself now?
And I'm trying to get a clear run.
Are you now saying to yourself, cool, blimey, I've got absolutely no chance here, or is there still hope?
Well, there is hope, because Helaf and Lamtara came from last and second last.
Yeah.
And you can see Michael is about 2 lengths in front of us, and myself and Pat, luckily we start, getting into our gear and find ourselves some room.
Yeah.
And we're not even fully straight yet, and we're just on the heels of Michael.
Yeah. And now this is where
if we were good enough, we were going to get him, and he pressed the button and
he's left you.
This is class.
Yeah.
That's the difference between a winner and a place horse.
And that was first time out. He hasn't had a run this season.
Just look at this.
Yeah. Look at that. He's devouring the ground. He's gone past Jack Jennings. He really is. You're coming on the outside.
Yeah, that's right. You can only do the turn of foot once. And once he nicked 5 lengths, basically we're just staying on and pegging him back. But he had too much turn of foot for us.
Thanks for taking us round, riding the Derby course with Frank Editore. Thanks, Frank.
Thanks.
And news of the stewards' inquiries take them ages to unravel everything today, but they have looked at the film regarding Michael Hills's riding of the winner Shaamit, whether he hit the horse too much or too hard or whatever. They said there was no case to answer. They've now studied Pat Edery's riding, thinking he may have used it excessively according to the guidelines, and they feel that he is in the clear as well. So thank heaven to some of us who are on the side of the fence to think that horses are there to try and work hard and not to be abused, but to try and work hard in the moments of crisis. There is going to be no action about the use of the whip in this Colts Classic. So that's clear at this stage. Also news that Tony Whelan, who has got 3 days for his ride on Arctic Courier in the apprentice race, has got 3 days suspension for that. More news, a full wind up after the race.
Curry's biggest ever sale now on. Save £100 on this new Candy 1000 Spin Aquaviva Auto Washer. Only Curry's bring you all this.
It's Sunday morning, and I'm preparing my favourite breakfast. The main ingredient has to be shredded wheat. Just 100% whole wheat with no added sugar or salt. And then, only because it's Sunday, mind, I add just the top of the milk. And I sit in my favourite chair.
I don't mind another chair, but I wouldn't want another cereal.
Shredded wheat in bite size. There is no better cereal.
With a Pentium processor inside your PC, open the doorway to legendary internet sites, like St. Andrews. For the best of the internet, it's the Intel Pentium processor. With a Pentium processor inside your PC, open the doorway to fast-moving programs, like FIFA 96. For the best of PC software, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Yes, Mum?
Does one remember offering one dinner?
Hold on.
Well, one was just passing.
Oh.
Luckily with Findus, you're prepared for anything. New Creator Stir Piler. Simply pour out the amount you want and stir. A delicious, complete meal in 6 minutes.
Mum, remember offering if one needed a babysitter?
I'm sure you wasn't prepared for that.
With Findus, you're prepared for anything.
Carling Premier, in a world that's losing its head, a lager that doesn't.
Dear Volkswagen, I can't stop imagining what my girlfriend's been up to. 2 weeks ago, she arrived home with a brand new Polo. When I questioned her about it, she insisted it only cost £7,760. What sort of fool does she take me for? Everyone knows they're expensive. I dread to think how she got hold of the money. Please, send me some written proof so I can confront her. I've got to know. I'm at my wit's end. Yours desperately, Kevin Morris.
Just have a look down here, because they might not be the most beautiful legs in the world. I'm talking about those legs, but they've covered a few miles. They belong to Michael Cow. Tell us, what have you been doing walking to the Derby? What's all this about?
It's a traditional walk we've had, Derek, for many, many years from the Nutley Old Pub in Reigate. And I've done it for the last 20 years, but I'm guaranteed by some of the older participants, some of them are sadly not here anymore, yeah. It's been going on since 1924 as an organised walk.
How many of you take part?
It's roughly about 100 every year.
Yeah. And how many miles is that?
I suppose it's about 8 as a crow flies, but it's a bit undulating over the hills and can be a bit difficult, especially on the way home.
And I bet it is
back as well.
But what about refreshments? I mean, how do you look after yourself?
Well, thankfully there's about 6 pubs on the route, and although we start at 1 at 7:30 in the morning for breakfast, yeah, there is another 5 en route,
yeah,
and it's a well-welcome rest from the walk.
Did you back the winner?
I got second again.
Second!
Again.
Should have been watching the mourner. Yeah. By the way, what do you do? You're a what?
I'm a roofer in Reigate.
A roofer in Reigate. And I tell you what, I think you can do it without a ladder, this fella, can't you?
Oh, thanks very much.
Thanks, Eric. Mate. And safe journey home.
Yeah, we will.
And I like the legs.
Yeah, right.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Now a result from Haydock on the 4:45. First number 3, Future Prospect, the 5-4 on favourite. Second number 5, Swino at 8-1. And third number 4, Magic Blue at 12-1. 6 round.
So the close of another Derby day, the solution to another Derby puzzle. Time to look back. Shaamit triumphs in his Derby hour at the end of the show, but in every race, Epsom has thrills to spare.
past the 2 furlong marker, and Selhurst Park Flyer goes on. Here comes My Best Valentine in the yellow and blue behind it. Shamanic starts to pick up, and then comes Joe Maximus, Golden Pound behind the ears, but it's a duel with a furlong to go between next to the rails. Selhurst Park Flyer with the noseband, who's proving the stronger of My Best Valentine, and Selhurst Park Flyer going on. Selhurst Park Flyer lengthening his stride. My Best Valentine is second at the post. Selhurst Park Flyer, My Best Valentine, Tropical Dance finishes third. And it's Hannah Faye that's gone into the lead, but here comes Dance So Sweet next to the rails. These are one and two, Country Lover, Casual Water, Rising Clover and Arctic Courier, all playing for places. They're inside the final furlong now, and it's Dance So Sweet on the far side under young David O'Neill, who's taken a length out of the pack and is going to take this. It's Dance So Sweet striding on, Dance So Sweet from Hannah Faye. Here comes Achilles Heel, but it's Dance So Sweet, Achilles Heel, Hannah Faye, one, two and three. And it's Tertium on the wide outside that goes for home in the lead. Hardy Dancer, conspicuous. Eli Ardensky starts to pick up there. Maralinga, Ho Express could get placed. It's Tertium in the lead as they stride inside the final furlong. Tertium in the lead, but here comes Eli Aristocrati from the clouds. Where has this one been? He's going to take it. Eli Aristocrati, Tertium, one and two. Swain has it. Now, they ride a lot of these races in France, go slow, 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 then rush. So it could well suit Swain, this. He still has the edge, but Singspiel is putting in a finish. Punishment and Dequest is fourth. They've got just over a quarter of a mile to go. It's going to be a real kick finish, this. Mick Kinnan on the outside in the white cap. Frankie Dettori, the star cap, going from Punishment. Dequest is fourth of the four. They're inside the final furlong, and Swain and Singspiel, stride for stride they are. And as they race up towards the line, Swain and Singspiel still stride for stride, locked in combat. But Swain just going into the lead, he's proving the stronger. And at the line, Swain, Singspiel, 1-2.
And they weren't that easy to find today. We started at 1:45 with the winner there, number 13, Selhurst Park Flyer, at 12-1. Then the Vodafone Derby went to number 14, Shaamit, at 12-1 also. 3:10, number 2, Dance So Sweet, at 6-1. In the 3:50, number 1, Eli Aristocrati, at 16-1. And then the Vodafone Coronation Cup went to the favourite, number 4, Swain, at 11-10.
Still to come, your last chance to see how your Derby money was won and lost. We'll be back in 60 seconds.
Would you rather remain anonymous or choose a luxury sports saloon that provokes discussion?
Hey! Ooh, cool CD! Come, yeah. Not from my street, from HMV at the airport! No pay VAT, funky!
Money you save mean extra dough for steamy holiday pleasures, eh? It's crazy!
Why pay the VAT when you can spend the money with me? Hey! Why pay the VAT when you can spend the money with me?
Every day, our systems and services help improve essential services such as telecom, gas, water and power. ICL, information technology, supporting your way of life.
Any luxury car will make a statement about you. But why settle for a cliché?
Welcome back to Epsom. News is coming out of the weighing room of a three-day suspension for jockey Richard Quinn for dropping his hands on Punishment in the Coronation Cup. And that horse finished fourth, was just done for third place. His three-day ban will mean that he misses the first 2 days of Royal Ascot, and that could be costly, because I know Quinn had got some good rides up there, so he's been punished for his riding on Punishment. And Michael Hills and Pat Edry, no action against them, although the stewards did found that they marginally infringed the whip rule when finishing first and second in the Derby, but no action against them.
Now, details on today's Champion Tipster competition, and a big total required. Maximum points 261, and we're looking for 150 points or more. If you've got 150 or more, you can ring 0990 100 366, 0990 100 366, and the lines are open until midnight tonight. Tomorrow, another champion tipster competition, four live races, the first at 3:10, same rules apply, and the number to call 0891 99 1148.
Now, have you won the picture puzzle on Derby Day? Yes, it was, of course, Stormtrooper. Let's see if you have won £100. Richard McDermott has. Well done, Richard, from Strud in Gloucestershire. Sarah Webster, £100 cheque on its way to you from Crewe in Cheshire. And Paul Christopher from Parkson Pool in Dorset. Well done to you. That's the winners of the picture puzzle on Derby Day.
Join us again tomorrow, 3 o'clock here, four races live. But we leave you with a last look at Shaamit's great triumph. A first derby for Michael Hills and William Haggas. And of course, when you recount the story, yet another taste of Epsom glory for the family of Lester Piggott. Good night.